Nothing like fresh gator meat. Go Tigers. Beat the Gators.
On CBS, the second game of our doubleheader this afternoon from Baton Rouge, Louisiana. At long last, a Saturday home game for the Tigers of LSU. It has been long anticipated. It's finally here. The LSU Tigers take on the Florida Gators, both teams with one defeat in this critical SEC battle. Because of Hurricane Katrina, this is the first Saturday home game for the Tigers. It's the latest opening date since October of 1913, when LSU defeated Jefferson College. So you can imagine the pent-up anticipation of the 92,000 who have gathered in this venerable old stadium, and how much they have all gone through this fall. If it's taken this long, why not bask in the sunlight and enjoy the moment? The Tigers about to take the field. We welcome you. Good afternoon, everybody. Vern Lundquist along with Todd Blackledge and Tracy Wolfson. This one featuring two teams from great football programs, both schools with first-year head coaches, both schools with lofty preseason ambitions, and both schools have been stung by the bee. LSU lost at home on a Monday night, a fall apart in the second half. They lost to Tennessee. The Gators of Florida went on the road 2 weeks ago and were trounced at Alabama. Thus the significance of this game. Let's take a look at the standings. Florida trailing Georgia, but they get the Bulldogs after a bye in 2 weeks. And out west, Alabama just did hold on to defeat Ole Miss a moment ago. LSU trailing, and they get Alabama in the middle of November. And Todd, what are your expectations for this one?
Well, even though both teams have some serious playmakers on offense, I think the game is going to come down to the other two phases of the game. Which defense can impose their will on the other team? Who wins the special teams battle? And when you talk about defense and special teams, well, that's been the formula for success for the Florida Gators all season. Urban Meyer said, that's what we are. We're a ball possession team. Last week against Mississippi State, big plays on the special teams led to 18 points. They downed two punts inside the one. That played right into the hands of the defense, who had six sacks and recorded two safeties against Mississippi State. The special teams also recovered a muff punt and just for good measure scored their own touchdown. D-Webb blocked a punt, recovered for a touchdown. Now, when you talk about LSU, after the first two games, I don't know who took more heat around here. Head coach Les Miles or new defensive coordinator Bo Pelini. But the last 2 weeks, lucky number 13, 13 sacks, and they've only given up 13 points. The big question, that was against Mississippi State and Vanderbilt. Can they play that same kind of dominant defense against a team with similar athletes today?
This game, as all of our games on the SEC on CBS, brought to you in high definition. Picture perfect mid-October Saturday afternoon, 83 degrees, 34% humidity, slight breeze out of the northeast, and the forecast for sunny skies. Florida leads this series. The teams have met every year since 1971, and Florida has won the last three at LSU. And let's check in with Tracy Wolfson. Trace.
Thanks, guys. Before last week's game, former Gator and Dallas Cowboys Smith spoke to this Florida team, and the message was, be there for your boys. He talked about overcoming adversity and injury and how that you have to continue to play tough as to not let his teammates down. He said about Troy Aikman and Michael Irvin, he didn't want to let them down. He said, play for each other, play as one. That's how a good football team becomes a great one. Urban Meyer told his team this week that message will be just as important today against LSU.
You know, Tracy, the two things that can really bring a football team together and help you circle the wagons, a disappointing loss and going on the road to play. So this plays right into the psyche of Florida today.
LSU won the toss. They have elected to defer their option to the second half. They will kick off, and the Gators will get the ball. Chris Jackson getting ready to tee it up. 10 touchbacks and 24 kickoffs. Jackson also doubles as the long-range field goal kicker. Gavin Dickey, one of the deep men. And Marcus Manson is back, running back.
I think we're going to see more of Marcus Manson today. He played very well last week in the win over Mississippi State. Deshaun Wynn, a little banged up with his shoulder. I expect to see number two quite a bit today.
Ford has gone for a sartorial change as well. Last time we saw them on the road, they had the orange pants and the white jerseys. Not that there's superstition, and not that there's anything wrong with that. This one comes out to the 20.
Sartorial?
No, it's a perfectly legitimate word.
I don't know what it means. It sounds great, but I mean, I've got to bring a dictionary.
You got to hang with me.
Good.
Chris Leak, 62%, but he's thrown two interceptions in each of the last two games.
Yeah, he started out the first four games, 10 touchdowns, no interceptions. The last two games, one touchdown, four interceptions.
And I believe Jamel Cornelius is on the field to start the game, which, check in a moment, that's great news for Florida. He's missed the last one. He's wide at the top of the screen. Here's the handoff to Sean Wynn. Plunges out for 5 yards to the 25-yard line. We have introduced you to Chris Leak, and now you see Deshaun Wynn. Let's check this starting lineup for the Gators. Up front, Hand, Washington, DeGore, Ristler, and Butler. They were dominated in the loss at Alabama. Deshaun Wynn in the backfield, Jackson, Cornelius, and Dallas Baker. The tight end is Tate Casey, and of course, Andre Caldwell, the leader of this team. There's Cornelius. Caldwell out with a broken leg, watching back home in Gainesville. Second down, five. Three down as LSU defends, and this one, flag is thrown. Yep. Intended for Dallas Baker, and I think Ronnie Prude is going to be called for interference.
Now, Ronnie Prude didn't know where the football was. He was locked up in coverage, and Dallas Baker has become the go-to guy here the last couple weeks. And you see Prude gets hung up on him and never knows the football's coming, and there draws the flag.
On the defense, number 8, that is a spot foul, an automatic first down.
Terry Brown, our referee, and the Tigers open as expected in the nickel defense against this spread option offense. Oliver, Roten, Williams, and Pittman, the two in the middle, are terrific. The two linebackers in the nickel, Cameron Vaughn and Allie Highsmith, and the five defensive backs, Prude, Landry, Jesse Daniels, Chivas Jackson, and Jonathan Zenon, number 19, who is the nickelback. First down at the 35. Here's Leak, pulls it back, fires it deep. And contact is made at the 45, but ruled incidental. It's an incomplete pass intended for Chad Jackson, defended by Jesse Daniels.
Very interesting to watch how LSU comes out defensively here these first few possessions. An odd front. It looks like a three-man line, but one of the defensive ends, Chase Pittman, is in a stand-up position. But that's the kind of look that Alabama caused so many problems for Florida with. And if LSU can get pressure on Chris Leak with only three or four, it's going to be another long afternoon for the Gator offense.
Florida, as you saw with the graphic, has not opened in impressive fashion in six games. Second down and 10. And the blitz coming from the corner. The little shovel pass offside underneath, and offside is going to be ruled. There's a flag at the 35.
Kyle Williams, one of their stalwarts up front, number 95, right over the center. This is the most penalized team in the SEC. Here's Kyle Williams. He's going on the sound of the quarterback's voice. and the most prominent single penalty for this team has been offsides, and that's the ninth offsides penalty, but there was movement.
And so the penalty goes against Florida. Instead, just to emphasize the point Todd was making, though, last week 14 penalties for LSU. So it's a real concern for Les Miles in his first year as the head coach. Came from Oklahoma State, where he got them into bowl games in three consecutive years. Both teams heavily penalized. You've got the 11 and 12 teams in the SEC in terms of yards per game. Pittman coming. They read it, and Baker comes back to make the catch, and a misconnection between the two.
And that's when you have a 6'4" guy rushing unblocked, he's going to get into the throwing lane. And Chase Pittman didn't get a sack, but he got his hands up enough to cause Chris Leak to make a poor throw to Dallas Baker, too far to the inside.
You see Chris Leak emphasize you needed to curve that a little bit. So there was a mix-up with the two.
I was down on the field before the game talking to offensive coordinator Dan Mullen, and he said, you know, we've got to be good on first down. When we've had trouble, we've got to second and 15. Now it's third and 15. Hard to call plays with that.
Gavin Dickey is wide to the right. There's the option pitch right side to Jamel Cornelius. Boy, he is high-low at the 32-yard line. Terrific pursuit led by Jesse Daniels, number 31.
This is the shovel pass version of the option. The first read is underneath for the shovel pass. It's not there, so now you try to get the ball to the perimeter. But again, the speed of this LSU defense, Highsmith and Jesse Daniels there for the stop.
Eric Wilbur, after a slow start to the season, has come on the last couple of games, but he's kicking to the very... Oh, it's a little rugby game. How about that? A little move to the right.
Well, that's because of Skylar Green.
Yes.
They don't want to kick the ball to him in the middle of the field. They kick it right to the boundary, and it's an effective punt.
40 yards, but the most significant stat, no return. LSU has the ball when we return. Welcome back to Death Valley. LSU and its quarterback, Jamarcus Russell, with the first offensive set. Russell, the sophomore from Mobile, Alabama, and for the season, 64%, only two interceptions.
I got to tell you, in terms of just throwing the football, when this guy is on balance and has his feet set, I don't know that I've ever seen anybody have a stronger arm or throw the ball more efficiently or effectively as this guy.
On first down, he will throw, lobs it out, he'll touch on the right side. And it's out of bounds. Joseph Addai makes the grab, and he's up to the 36 on first down. D. Webb with the tackle. Offensively, up front, Whitworth, Arnold, Neiswanger, Livings, and Johnson. Joseph Addai, one of three fine running backs. Kevin Stelz, the fullback. Early Doucette gets the start, along with Dwayne Bowe at wideouts. And the tight end is David Jones. Second down and three. Jacob Hester is in at fullback now, number 18, on the second down. Hester leads the way as they go left. Addai has the handoff. Brandon Seiler forces the play inside. Earl Everett comes up and makes the tackle. There's also a flag down at the 45-yard line. First down if the play stands.
It was really good patience by Joseph Addai, not rushing that to the perimeter, waiting until a crease opened up. Florida defenders indicating the penalty is going against LSU.
Dead ball. Personal foul. Late hit on the defense, number 93. The result of the play is a first down. The penalty will be assessed 15 yards from the end of the run. First down.
Stephen Harris is the guilty man.
There you see Everett with the tackle, and must have happened away from the football on a potential blocker, but tack on 15 more, and outstanding field position now for LSU on their first possession of the football.
Second penalty in the early going against Florida. Urban Meyer said of his team when they lost 31-3 at Alabama, "We were exposed. They were dominated in that game. Came back and won last week against Mississippi State." And now this critical encounter against LSU. Jamarcus Russell, a lot of time. Nice pass inside.
Nice defense. And Bo
had it knocked away. Jarvis Herring and D. Webb were there.
This is going to be a good matchup to watch today. D. Webb's the best cover guy for Florida, but he's only 5'11". And Dwayne Bowe is 6'3" and 217 pounds, a physical receiver. He gets both hands on the ball, but Webb doesn't give up on the play and strips it out of there. You know, you mentioned that Urban Meyer said they got exposed. I think the other thing that happened in Tuscaloosa, they got overwhelmed in the first 4 minutes of the game. They gave up the 87-yard touchdown on Alabama's first play. Chris Leak threw his first interception, and before they knew it, it was 14-0.
Second down and 10 here, scoreless first quarter. Early Doucette in motion. Here's the toss. Adai comes right, gets a good kick-out block by Hester, but excellent pursuit by this Florida defense. And they have an outstanding defensive line, as does LSU. It's Joe Cohen replacing Ray McDonald, who might be back next week. Might. Marcus Thomas, Stephen Harris, Jeremy Mincy. The linebackers, McCullough, Everett on either side of the middle linebacker, Brandon Seiler. And the secondary, D. Webb, Kyle Jackson, Jarvis Herring, and Vernell Brown.
Jeremy Mincy is one of the real leaders up there. 10 tackles last week, and he leads the team in tackles. I mean, very rarely does a defensive end lead your team. It's usually your middle linebacker or your free safety. It's the defensive end.
Third and 10, blitz coming. Seiler's on the blitz. They go deep. He's got a man all by himself. Touchdown, LSU. Benny Brazell, who has world-class speed. Titles as a member of the track and field team. His first touchdown.
This was a beautiful throw by Jamarcus Russell as well, because Jarvis Herring had a bead on the play, but the ball just hung in the air enough for Brazell to run under it before the defender got there.
Colt David for the extra point, number 6, young man out of Grapevine, Texas. Well, Alabama threw a home run, 87 yards. Croyle to Prothrow. This time it's Jamarcus Russell to Benny Brazell. 43-yard touchdown.
A little crossing route by the wideouts. Tony Joyner got fooled. The other safety couldn't help. LSU on the board first, 7-0.
Gets major kudos on that one.
Time now for the Hartford playbook. That touchdown deserves to be our play, presented by the Hartford. Florida is going to come on a corner blitz. Benny Brazell is going to run out and up, and the guy who is going to get caught in the wash is Tony Joyner, a backup safety who is in on the play. He's going to have to take man responsibilities with the blitz, and he just kind of gets frozen when the receivers come together. Jamarcus Russell reads it. Jarvis Herring not able to get over in time to help from his free safety position, and a beautiful throw and catch, Russell to Brazell.
That is the first career touchdown catch for Benny Brazell. 5 plays. It took a minute, 38 seconds. Now Chris Jackson getting ready to kick off. Jamel Cornelius had been one of the kickoff return men before he turned the ankle and missed last week's game. So Manson and Gavin Dickey are the two deep men here. Here's Jackson. This one returnable, and it will be, by Marcus Manson. And he spilled at the 15-yard line.
Great coverage.
Let's go back now to the studio for a game-changing performance powered by Pontiac. Here's Tim Brando.
Vern, with under 3.5 to play, Matt Ryan came in for an ineffective Quentin Porter, and he led BC to a late comeback. 26 yards to Kevin Challenger. That is the winning touchdown. It was reviewed. They overcome 5 turnovers and a block punt to win 35-30 to stay in the ACC race in the Atlantic Division with Florida State. Vern?
All right, Tim, thank you. Florida trails by 7. They've got the ball 85 yards away.
Same defensive look for LSU. A 3 down line, 1 defensive end standing up. Very similar to what Alabama did to this team.
Leak, it's tipped. Knocked down by Chase Pittman. Young man who began his collegiate career at the University of Texas, played there 1 year, transferred here.
Here's Pittman here. Now he's coming from a stand-up position, so his hands are already above his waist. He's not coming off the ground, and he's looking right at the quarterback. He's playing screen. He gets his hands up. He caused one throw to be altered, and that time he tipped one.
Pittman from Shreveport. Chris Leak from Charlotte, North Carolina. Last two games, one touchdown, four interceptions. Here's the toss, and a great job defense. Oh, wow. Little stutter set by Deshaun Wynn, and he works very hard for 5 yards up to the 20.
Last week, LSU on defense just went after Jay Cutler. I mean, they had him, the quarterback from Vanderbilt, backpedaling the whole game. They sacked him 6 times. They blitzed almost all the time in passing situations. So far today, I think their philosophy is, look, we don't need to all-out blitz Chris Leak. That's when he picks people apart, when he leaves people open. Alabama didn't blitz him. They rushed with 3 and 4 and made him read things, and that's what LSU is doing right now.
Leak back, blitz coming. Picked up nicely, the pass behind Dallas Baker. There's a tussle, and whatever contact is ruled incidental. So Leak starts out 0-for-4, and Florida's going to punt again. Bo Pelini, in his first year as the defensive coordinator, served last year as the co-coordinator for Bob Stoops at Oklahoma. Prior to that, defensive coordinator and interim head coach at Nebraska. Eric Wilbur on to punt. Skylar Green, let's see what Florida has in mind tactically for this one. LSU with potential great field position. They'll do the same thing as he goes sideways.
Has ball it came bounce. Back to the middle, though.
And there's Skylar Green. Good pursuit. Green forced out of bounds at the 36.5-yard line. A 44-yard punt. One on the return. And Tony Joyner is there to force Skylar Green out of bounds. 7-0, first quarter, LSU. Just a small list of what this LSU team, its fans, have been through this year. Games postponed, moved. Here's Andrew Whitworth, the offensive tackle.
I don't think you can explain it. I think it's almost a sigh of relief, you know, to get to play a normal week, get back to business, get back to what we do, you know, playing football and you know, something we work so hard for year round and finally get a chance to have normal weeks and play games and the fans get to come and you know, it's a Saturday in Tiger Stadium and it's our first of the year in the middle of October. So, you know, who would have predicted that?
First of the year in the middle of October.
You know, and I don't know that if somebody has never played or coached or been involved in football understands how significant your routines and your patterns and your practice and meeting times and everything, your travel, all that is, you're so used to routine, and when it's disrupted, and nobody has ever been more disrupted than this team this year, really set them back.
Jamarcus Russell with a play fake on first down, sets the screen to a die, and he's got a lot of room. He's got a blocker downfield to help as well. That was Will Arnold, number 73. Now, that might have been a block in the back. Might.
Well, one thing you can see right now with Jamarcus Russell is that he looks comfortable running this offense. When Les Miles came in, one of the real smart things he did, I think, was retain Jimbo Fisher, his offensive coordinator. Jimbo, this is his sixth year.
Doing a run, holding on the offense, number 76. Filling 10 yards from the spot of the foul. Replay first down.
Well, that's Andrew Whitworth, from whom you just heard. He told us yesterday he senses a little swagger from Jamarcus Russell in the huddle that he did not have last year as a freshman.
Well, the last 2 weeks, I mean, he has played outstanding. He was the SEC Offensive Player of the Week last week against Vanderbilt, 21 of 32. He was 21 of 24 against Mississippi State the week before. And Jimbo told us the biggest change in him is he's starting to become a quarterback. His game management skills and his handle on the offense is what's really changed.
After the penalty, first down and 8 at the 39. Nice swinger over the ball, the center. And they'll run the draw to a die. He's got a lot of room. Comes right. He gets a good block from Dwayne Bowe on Demetrius Webb. And Joseph Addai picks up a quick 30.
Well, this is what, when you hear coaches say, we gashed him on that play, this is gashing a defense. It's not a real complicated play, but watch the interior of the Florida defense get gashed. Brandon Seiler came on the blitz. He got taken out of the play, and a huge opening for Addai. And then you've got wide receivers blocking downfield like Dwayne Bowe that add on about 10, 15 more yards to an already positive run.
Justin Vincent now in the lineup. The junior who had the sensational freshman season fell off a year ago. Vincent gets the handoff, goes left, caught and dropped at the 30. Marcus Thomas with a tackle, and
Florida comes up with the ball. Are they calling it a fumble?
They are indeed.
Justin Vincent into the game to give Adai a little bit of a break. And not quite ready to protect the football. What a break for the Florida defense. Here's Brandon Seiler right here. He's going to run to the football, get off his block. It looks like Marcus Thomas may have knocked the football out, and Seiler is the guy who comes up with it. But a huge break for the Florida defense after getting gashed on the play before. Seven nothing LSU, but Florida with a huge turnover by their defense. Marcus Thomas, number 44, is going to run down the line, get a hand on the football and rip it out, and Brandon Seiler is going to come up with the football. And you know, Marcus Thomas, he along with Jeremy Mincy are the two guys that have really stepped up on this defensive line in the absence of Ray McDonald. They've played outstanding football this season.
Florida, as you see, 10th straight. They forced a turnover, and that is the ninth fumble this season for LSU. They've had trouble with ball security. Here's Deshaun Wynn, nothing there. And let's check back in once again our New York studios. Here is Tim Brenda.
All right, Vern, thank you. Texas, a 90-yard drive culminated here with Vince Young taking it in from a yard out. Trust me, it happens. Longhorns will play the least appreciated unbeaten team in the country, Texas Tech, in 1 week.
All righty. Thank you, Tim.
Once again, first down has been a tough down for Florida. You see 1.7 yards, and that they can't operate in this offense without being more successful on first down. They've got to get into manageable third down situations for Chris Leak.
Second and nine here. Leak pops it left side. Jamel Cornelius is hit as he makes the grab. Down at the 39-yard line. Watch an exclusive SEC college football highlight and get complete coverage of all of today's action. Check it out tonight on CBSSportsLine.com. That should be exclusive college football highlights. I forgot the S. It's very important. Highlights. You don't just get
zero.
One. Yeah, zero.
SEC highlight.
Multiple SEC highlights. Second down, third down, and very short.
Well, this is a manageable third down. That big play on second down, they're substituting into a bigger, more of a short yardage offensive formation. LSU likewise subs on defense.
Late group, they'll go to the hurry up on third and inches. That's Billy Latsko, the lead blocker, and Deshaun Wynn plunges over right guard and gets the first down.
I think Deshaun Wynn looks okay today. There was some concern about his shoulder. They tried to hold him out of the game last week, but they felt they needed him for a couple key runs. But they said he didn't look a whole lot better this week, and they were going to judge early. If he looked like he was turning his shoulders when he got towards contact, they may not have played him much today, but he's sticking it up in there pretty good so far in the ball game.
First down and 10. Leak looks back over at the sideline and changes the play. Chris Leak did not practice all of last week because of a bruised shoulder. He took every snap in practice this week. Here's a quick flip. It's hit again. That's the second knockdown we've had. That's Ryan Willis, number 52.
And Chris Leak, even though he's frustrated, is probably fortunate that Willis knocked it down, because if it doesn't get knocked down, I think this one gets intercepted and returned for a touchdown. Ronnie Prude is all over Dallas Baker right now. I mean, it looks like what they've told Ronnie Prude is, forget about what the other 10 guys are doing. I want you to lock on Dallas Baker and don't let him out of your sight.
Leak with a very modest start, 1 of 6 for 8 yards. There's the little shovel pass inside. Good job of. There's some homework that's been done on that one. Ryan Willis again, number 52. Let's check the play prior to this one, Todd.
Well, we've seen these two locked up three times already. And, I mean, he was right on this wide receiver screen. If that ball doesn't get knocked down, Ronnie Prude might step right in front of it. He's had one penalty called on him, but he has been all over Dallas Baker early in this football game.
Third and 10, Deshaun Wynn breaks and goes way wide right. They're five men out, empty backfield. Four men down for LSU, and now the change made by Chris Lee, timeout.
This was the first time that LSU showed blitz, and they waited it for it to be an empty backfield. They could get more guys than Florida could block. Chris Lee said, I think I'll take a timeout. Three, four, five, six guys threatening to rush. That's one more than Florida can block. Chris Lee tried to call an audible, change the play, didn't have time to do it. Confusion for the Florida offense. Wisely took the timeout. Jamel Cornelius has not practiced much the last 2 weeks. He had no idea what they were doing. A very smart decision by Chris Leak to call timeout.
Thus, it's third and 10. Urban Meyer looks on. Marcus Manson is on, and he's wide to the right side, top of the screen. Again, the empty backfield. The blitz is coming.
Six coming.
Leak goes deep for Chad Jackson, and it's incomplete. Intended by LaRon Landry.
And did you see Chris Leak throw this ball off his back foot? He knew the blitz was coming. Watch Chris Leak not set his feet because he thinks the blitz is going to get to him. He's drifting, he's fading away, and he doesn't get enough on this throw to make an accurate throw to the sideline. LaRon Landry in coverage, but Chris Leak made a poor throw because he never got his feet set.
Skylar Green second in the country in punt returns. And he awaits this punt now from Eric Wilbur at the 20-yard line. This time Wilbur kicks it. That's a dandy punt and a fair catch called by Skylar Green, and he pins Green at the 11 or the 10 yard line. He was once described as a bell cow of the Indianapolis Colts, right?
Ron Meyer.
Bell cow. Hokenborg. Here's a handoff for a yard. Oh, let's ease up for just a moment. Go back to Tim Brando in New York.
All right, fellas, I'll try to deliver this easily. Quarterback Vince Young will do it himself. This is what the Heisman Trophy candidate does so very well. And they get 14-0 late in the first quarter against Colorado. And behind Lindell White and Reggie Bush touchdowns, Travis Thomas has also gone in for Notre Dame. The Trojans lead the Irish by 7. Vern?
All right, thank you, Tim. Second down and 8. Play fake. Russell got a man way. Oh, my goodness. Early Doucette. What he was pass. So wide open. Had Russell seen him earlier, that would have been about an 85-yard touchdown.
Well, normally when you run this bootleg, you're looking for the underneath throw, not the wide receiver. But he came open quickly before Russell was ready to make the throw. When he did throw it, Doucette made an outstanding adjustment to the football for the catch.
Russell, 24-yard gain. Early Doucette, who got the start today in place of the injured Craig Buster Davis.
Doucette is the guy who caught the game-winning touchdown in the opener against Arizona State on a 4th-and-10 play.
First down and 10. This is a die. Earl Everett is there, number 30 defensively. Well, that 4th-and-10 from 39 yards out, Todd. A magical win, it appeared, for LSU against Arizona State.
And it was a tremendous throw by Jamarcus Russell. I talked about his ability to throw. Moving to his left, just flicked his wrist, and the ball perfectly thrown to Doucette. And in that fourth quarter, some credit also has to go to the LSU special teams because they really ignited the comeback in the fourth quarter. They blocked a field goal and a punt and returned both of them for touchdowns to set up that comeback.
Second down and 8. Four down for Florida defensively. Motion, free play. Russell fires it out, incomplete. You know, in that they did get those two special teams plays, that was the first time, as far as research shows, that an SEC team had blocked two kicks for touchdowns in the same game since Punt Bama Punt in 1971. Auburn over Alabama.
Offsides on the defense, number 44. Penalty's 5 yards. Remains second down.
Marcus Thomas. Second down and three. And again, these two heavily penalized teams performing to form.
And it was interesting when we talked to Les Miles yesterday about penalties. You know, he was very careful to say, we've got to make better decisions, but I really don't want to slow down our guys' intensities. If they're flying around and penalties are the result of that, I can live with that a little more as long as we make better decisions.
Hand off a die. Good defensive job. Marcus Thomas.
He made up for the penalty.
Did he ever?
He's really playing well on the inside. And this is one of those guys that they thought for a good part of his career he was underachieving on the Florida defensive line. He's 6'3", 285-pounder out of Jacksonville, but he has played really well this season on the inside. They had Ray McDonald, who was their best defensive end, who got hurt in the Tennessee game. Jeremy Mincy has really picked it up. Ray McDonald practiced this week. He's hoping to be back for the Georgia game, their next football game.
Well, he is here in uniform. We do not expect him to play. Third and four, 7-0 ball game. Russell comes right. Brandon Seiler chases him. The pass is incomplete, and LSU will punt.
Well, that was a nice play by Seiler. He just ran right through the block of Joseph Addai. And Addai is a pretty physical guy as the tailback at 215 pounds. But because Seiler exploded through that block, he forced Jamarcus Russell to throw that ball away.
First punt for Chris Jackson and LSU. It comes on fourth and four. And this has been a troublesome spot for Florida. Punt returns, not something at which they have excelled. Look at that. 100th out of 117 Division I teams. Jackson nice and high. Fair catch call. Vernell Brown grabs it at the 13-yard line. Doubleheader for you tomorrow. The NFL on CBS. First game headlined by Jacksonville at Pittsburgh. And the second game, the highlight game, New England to take on the Broncos out in the Rocky Mountains. It all begins with the NFL today with Greg, Dan, Shannon, and Boomer. It'll be a preview of the NFL today of the Bill Romanowski story. I believe there's an admission of steroid use in the entire story on 60 Minutes tomorrow night. Here's a low snap. Deshaun Wynn gets the handoff and a couple of yards out near the 17-yard line. 7-0, late first quarter. The only score, a touchdown toss, Jamarcus Russell to Benny Brazell, 43 yards.
So one of the things about this offense, this spread option offense, is when you have a quarterback who runs the option, even when he hands off, he's exposing himself to hits. Now, this doesn't look like a huge hit from Chase Pittman, but he gets knocked on the ground. And quarterbacks don't like to get knocked on the ground. He's been sacked a bunch of times, and those knockdowns add up as well.
Second and 7. There's the option and the pitch. And Deshaun Wynn with an old-fashioned stiff arm, but he's cut down at the 20. It's going to leave third and 4. Chivas Jackson with the tackle. Todd, so much conversation about the spread option. Does it not work in the SEC?
Well, you know, the jury's still out a little bit. I think it can work as they try to get the ball to the perimeter. The run is not there, and Chris Leak does what he has to do, get the ball out to the pitch, but Deshaun Wynn just not able to get to the perimeter. I think the key is, I think this offense can work if they get to the point where they are operating at top speed and top efficiency. They're not there right now, so the defenses, the speed of the defenses in the SEC are making it tough for them to run this. If they get up to speed, I think they'll be able to do it.
Fighting the play clock now with 2 seconds to go. They do get the snap. The blitz comes. Leak lobs it deep. It's way too thick. He had to hurry because he was under intense pressure from Allie Highsmith, number 7.
Bo Pelini has been blitzing only a few times. This time Highsmith there again. The empty backfield, it appears, is when they want to go after Chris Leak in the passing situations. Leak trying to beat the blitz and just kind of threw it down the middle to no one.
Florida now 1 of 5 on third downs. They have had problems on third down conversions the last two games. Here's the little run and the kick, and they try and keep it away from Skylar Green, and again, very effective. very effective. 36-yard punt, but the significant stat there, nada on the return.
Well, I think one thing that Jimbo Fisher may want to try to do is get the ball to Skylar Green in another way so that he is a part of this offense. I mean, he's one of those guys who, if he gets a lot of touches in the game, it usually means something good for the offense. If he's not going to touch it as a punt returner, then Jimbo Fisher needs to figure out ways to get him the football as a receiver.
Chiron Carey is on the field for the first time now. They gave Justin Vincent one carry, and he fumbled it. So the third tailback, Chiron Carey, is behind Jamarcus Russell. Kevin Stelz, the fullback, comes out. Here's Russell to throw. Look at all the time. Deep, wide open, Dwayne Bowe. How about the time that Russell had to throw the ball?
Well, they've run the ball for enough yards and successfully enough to make the play action effective. And see, play action pass blocking, if you're running with some success, it makes it a lot easier for offensive linemen to pass protect. Off play action. The linebackers come up on the fake. You see Earl Everett affected by the run fake, and they slip the receiver behind the linebackers. Dwayne Bowe, the big target, going across the middle.
Ray McDonald is on the field, number 95. There he is.
He's inside.
Injured in the Tennessee game, and another pre-snap penalty, I believe. A die goes left. Looked like there was penetration offside.
And it looked like it was Ray McDonald.
Yes, anxious to get going.
At first, it didn't look like he knew where he was supposed to line up, and then he obviously anxious and excited to be back in the ball game. Urban Meyer obviously feeling like they need a spark defensively. Greg Madison, one of the co-defensive coordinators who coaches the defensive line, said, you know, I'm not going to get too excited about Ray being back until I see him practice a lot. And he practiced some this week, but not a great deal. But he was in on that particular play and jumped off sides. And now he's out.
Greg Madison, who shares that responsibility with Charlie Strong.
Sides. On the defense, number 95. Penalty is 5 yards. Remains first down.
I ran into Ray's parents coming back from Tuscaloosa in the airport in Birmingham, and a nice couple. And they were concerned about Ray and when he'd be back, and they didn't want to make sure that he didn't come back too soon.
Now, that was echoed by some of his defensive teammates. Our conversations with them, Marcus Thomas said that earlier this week. Here's Russell, deep right side for Bowe, over Webb. Touchdown, Louisiana State University. 27 yards.
Well, twice we've seen Jamarcus Russell put just enough air on the deep throw to get beyond the defender. That time, the taller receiver, Bowe, was able to just wait for that ball as D. Webb got his feet tangled up beneath him.
Colt David for the extra point. Russell brilliant in the early going.
Dwayne Bowe had a tremendous training camp. Then he hurt his ankle. He was slow getting back early in the season. But he has caught 4 touchdowns in the last 3 games now for the LSU offense. 14-0 Tigers.
Final score. 14-0 LSU. Dwayne Bowe with another touchdown catch. Jamarcus Russell, 2 of 2 on the drive. He's now hit Benny Brazil and Dwayne Bowe for TDs. And D. Webb victimized on that last one. He is, I think, the best of their defensive backs.
And, the ball just hung in the air, and he was one-on-one out there, and he just kind of got tangled up. LSU now 177 yards of total offense to 28 for Florida.
Haven't seen the kind of domination in this game that we saw Alabama over Florida, but 14-0 is very reminiscent of what happened to Florida when they lost that game to the Crimson Tide. It got to 17-0 then, and this one through the end zone. Let's go back and take a look at the Jamarcus Russell pass.
Well, because the tight end David Jones is going to run a post pattern, that is going to keep the free safety over there. Therefore, you've got a one-on-one matchup right there. Bo against D. Webb running the post pattern. And D. Webb is not in bad position. He's all alone and he knows it, but he just kind of gets tangled up at the end, mistimes his jump, and Dwayne Bo goes up and catches the pass. It's one-on-one with no safety really able to help, and Jamarcus Russell throws his second touchdown of the game.
Yards per completion, overwhelming LSU advantage. First and 10, Leak. Hand off to Deshaun Wynn. And number 21 picks up about three. So a slow starting Florida offense again in their win over Tennessee and their loss at Alabama, the two best teams they've played. One touchdown in both of those games, and that came on a reverse.
Yeah, and they really struggled to get anything going in their running game as well. I mean, even though they outgained those two opponents rushing, in the case of Tennessee, they gained 68 yards and Tennessee had 66 yards. So they still have had trouble against the better defenses getting that running game going on the inside.
Redshirt freshman Marcus Manson is the running back now. Play fake to him. Pressure, Ryan Willis and Leak. There's a double team and a flag is down.
Ronnie Prude there just a hair early on the contact. LSU has really squeezed this offense. I mean, they are right on top of it. Everything Florida's trying to do. That time, Ronnie Prude just a hair early on the contact. An underneath throw to Chad Jackson. Prude reads it, but he's there too soon. And a break for Florida.
Pass interference on the defense, number 8, is a spot foul. An automatic first down.
That interference call with 26 seconds to go in the opening quarter. Second foul on Ronnie Prude here in the first quarter. And a first down and 10, still shy of the 30-yard line.
This has to be a run.
Billy Latsko is in. Play fake, Leak under some pressure, goes right, gets caught at the 36-yard line. Catch is made by Dallas Baker. Now with Caldwell out with the broken leg and Cornelius injured, really two starters, Chad Jackson and Dallas Baker, two of the four that they need. They'd like to have 10 receivers available. And Dallas Baker has come up big the last 2 weeks. Over 100 yards in each of those games.
Yep. Had 7 catches last week, 6 against Alabama.
And Chad Jackson is number 2 in the country in terms of receptions. That's the end of the first quarter with our score 14-0. LSU. We'll return to Baton Rouge after this message. And a word from your local station.
Against I, flesh of my flesh and mind of my mind. Two of a kind, but one won't survive. My image is reflecting the enemy's eye, and his image is reflecting mine at the same time.
Jamarcus Russell, a rather large young man.
He is a big quarterback.
He's thrown for 2 touchdowns, 6 of 8 thus far. He gets a rest here as Florida is on the field with a 2nd down and 1. Hand off to Sean Wynn. He gets the first down and is hit by Jesse Daniels. But this Todd Blackledge, this Florida offense continues to struggle.
It does, because they can't seem to put enough stress on a good defense. And that's what they've got to do. The LSU defense is clamping down on them. They've got to find a way to threaten horizontally, try to stretch the defense, make them cover the whole field, and vertically. And they haven't been able to do that. You know, they're kind of plodding around in there trying to run inside. They haven't been able to get the ball in the perimeter in the option game. And they haven't been able to throw it downfield off of play action. So they've got to find some way to stretch this LSU defense a little more effectively here in the second quarter.
Now you see that graphic. They've been outscored 70-3 on the road. First down and 10. Here's Leak. Pulls it up. Goes across the middle. Double covered. Almost picked off by LaRon Landry.
Well, LaRon Landry, first team All-SEC last year, has led the team in tackles the last 2 years. 2 interceptions on the season. Should have had his 3rd one right here. He read it perfectly, cut right in front of the intended receiver, Jackson, just not able to come up with the catch. That's a free safety playing center field, reading the quarterback's eyes, and dropped a pick.
Second and 10. Deshaun Wynn split way wide left. LSU with three down. They bring four. Ryan Willis coming in. Oh, boy. The pocket collapsed. Glenn Dorsey, number 72, overwhelmed the right tackle.
Yeah, and that's a problem. When you only rush four, if you're Florida, and you can't block four, you've got some problems. That's Risler, the right guard, who just gets blown by Glenn Dorsey. The strength of this LSU defense is their defensive front. It starts with Claude Roten and Kyle Williams, but the first guy off the bench in that tackle rotation, Glenn Dorsey, a sophomore, a big sack right there.
Look at the number of hurries already. Third and a ton. Third and 19. Empty backfield again. They rush only four. The pass is delivered and caught up at the 45-yard line by Dallas Baker. They needed 19. They come up seven short, and Eric Wilbur will be on the punt again.
Many times Urban Meyer said, what we want to do offensively, we need to get two first downs. If we can get two first downs and change field position, even if we don't score, that's our goal every offensive possession. Those first downs have been few and far between today for the Gators.
Skylar Green back at the 10. It's
look
an
at this
unusual formation. Yeah, look at this. They've got two way to the left. Here's Wilbur, three up backs to help provide protection. And Green's going to have to let this go, and it's going to be down inside the five. Well, Reggie Nelson last week down two at the one-yard line.
And they both resulted in safeties for the Florida defense. But, to quote an old friend of mine, these ain't the Mississippi State Bulldogs. Well, with the help of the Home Depot, let's see what made LSU's last touchdown drive successful. The toes for success. It started with a play-action pass to Dwayne Bowe. Made the big crossing route. A little bit of running success and enough running success to force Florida to put an extra safety up. Left one-on-one coverage, and Jamarcus Russell, his second touchdown pass of the day.
Well, in a battle of field position, Florida has pinned LSU well back. Time of possession, Florida, that's one of the areas they dominate in.
Yep.
And they've got the edge here, but they trail by 14. Here's Chiron Carey, gets the handoff and goes right, spilled at the six.
And this is where Jamarcus Russell, we talked about his development as a quarterback, as a game manager. This is where he needs to be very intelligent in what he does with the football. If a pass is called, don't force anything. They've got a 14-0 lead. They've dominated the game. And he just needs to be smart with the football here. Last year in Gainesville was his first start. And he threw two critical interceptions deep in his own territory that set up two Florida touchdown drives of 5 yards and 3 yards. And it was Florida that jumped out to a 14-0 lead last year in Gainesville.
Chiron Carey stays on the field. Skylar Green has replaced the tight end now on second down and eight. So three wideouts. And a running back. Russell hands it off to Carey. Caught behind the line. Stymied. And dropped at the six.
Marcus Thomas made the play. Forced it inside. Jamarcus Russell, how has he improved the last couple weeks? You see out at Arizona State, he made some big throws when his team needed it. He didn't throw an interception. So-so against Tennessee. Only 158 yards, and they really got conservative in the second half. And then the last 2 weeks against Mississippi State and Vanderbilt, he's really thrown the ball extremely well, and he's managed the game. And again, this is the situation here, third down and eight on his own 6 yard line. Be smart with the football.
Adai replaces Carey in the backfield. Three wides again. Little moving pocket as Jamarcus Russell lobs it out and throws it away. It'll be fourth down. So Florida's going to have its best field position of the first half.
A good defensive series, and they had him backed up after the good punt, and they held him there in three plays. And even if Vernell Brown doesn't improve on that punt return average for Florida, they'll still start out in great position.
Jackson 9 yards back. Vernell Brown at the LSU 40-yard line. Fourth and eight in a 14-0 game. Rushes on. They just about got it.
They sure did.
It looked like it was Reggie Nelson who almost got there. A fair catch call by Vernell Brown. That was within a whisker.
Well, they had the block punt last week against Mississippi State. It was D. Webb. And Terrence Holmes recovered for a touchdown. This time it was Reggie Nelson, who has been a special teams phenom for Florida so far. A hair away from a huge play.
Very small contingent of Florida folks here because of the housing difficulties in the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina, but the band, or some of the band, is here. And Florida is heading in that direction. Best field position of the first half, first and 10. Leak, deep left side. He's got Baker open, and he can't get there. Jonathan Zenon did a nice job of holding up the wide receiver. We go down to Tracy Wolfson.
Well, guys, with offensive coordinator Dan Mullen calling the plays from the booth now, Urban Meyer has been a lot more hands-on with his offense down here. This is the most I've seen Meyer go over and talk to his offense when they are on the bench. He's been speaking mostly to his leaders, DeGore, Leak, and Baker, asking them what they see out there, but a lot different than when Dan Mullen was down here.
Dan Mullen is upstairs for the second week in a row. It worked effectively last week in the win against Mississippi State. Here's the handoff up the middle. Keaston Moore, the freshman out of Arlington, Texas, who has started three games this year, gets the carry and picks up seven. What is the advantage, Todd, in having Dan Mullen upstairs?
Well, the advantage for him is, from a strategic standpoint, you can see things much better than you can on the field. So he can have all his play sheets and his defensive diagrams laid out in front of him. He can see better in terms of anticipating what plays to call. The negative is you don't have the feel and the face-to-face contact. You can't look your quarterback in the eye and see how he's doing. I mean, you can only talk to him on the telephone, and that's not the same.
Very important third down in the first half. And timeout called because the play clock was about to expire.
And I think this is a critical juncture for this 2005 season for the Florida Gators. They need to capitalize on this great field position.
Some seats just a bit better than others. Big play. 14-0, third and three.
Chris Leak, only 4 of 13 for the game. He needs to connect on this one. He needs to set his feet to make the throw.
Three down, empty backfield. Wynn is now alongside. And here's the quarterback draw, and he breaks loose, but he doesn't get the first down.
Melvin Oliver with an excellent play. It looked like Leak was going to squirt out and make the first down on second effort, but Melvin Oliver able to trip him up. Melvin Oliver's at the top of the screen, the defensive end. He's got his eyes up.
And they will go for it. They will go for it on fourth down.
Again, I think Urban Meyer says, look, our first five possessions, we didn't even cross midfield. Now we're on their side of the field. We've got to convert. And LSU says, let's get the right defense in to stop them.
9:13 to go, first half. Urban Meyer will go for it with this Florida offense on fourth and one, down by two touchdowns. All right, Tim, 9:16 to go, fourth down and one. Florida trailing by 14. And they've got the ball inside the 40 of the LSU Tigers. Baker goes wide left. Leak is under center. Mike DeGore, that's Billy Letzko in motion. They toss and come to the near side and do not get it.
Great play by Ronnie Prude, getting up in there first and then getting the other white jerseys to the football. Jesse Daniels is going to get credit for the tackle, but Ronnie Prude is the guy who made the play first. Watch number 8 shoot in and force this ball back inside. Deshaun Wynn left his feet. When he did, he lost any momentum or any forward charge, and LSU comes up with a huge stop on fourth down. It looked like that play could work because the blitz came inside and it was an outside toss, but Ronnie Prude kept outside leverage and forced the play inside.
Ball goes over on downs. Here's a fake reverse.
Fumble. He fumbled it.
Joseph Addai picked up by Jarvis Herring. And wow. Florida gets it right back at the 33.
How costly have the two turnovers been here in the first half for LSU? That one looked like it was never a clean exchange between Russell and Addai. He fumbled it almost immediately. Last week against Vanderbilt, they totally dominated but only led 9-3 at half because they had four turnovers. Here's the handoff. Addai never has it cleanly. The ball's on the ground, and Jarvis Herring from his safety spot up around the football comes up with a huge turnover. And once again, Florida a chance to redeem themselves after the miss on fourth down.
Jimbo Fisher, the offensive coordinator at LSU, said of Jarvis Herring, he's been there for 10 years.
Yeah.
First down and 10, second fumble of the ball game for the Tigers.
Florida's got to get the ball to Chad Jackson, too. They got to get him involved.
Leak goes deep. Far side incomplete. Jamel Cornelius, Jonathan Zenon, and a cheerleader does a backflip.
Yeah, you got a busted lip. You know, I mean, most cheerleaders don't wear mouthpieces, but maybe they should. And he's trying to catch the ball. He wants to get on TV catching the ball, and he ends up getting a fat lip instead.
Well, the agility paid off. Ouch.
Yeah.
Sometimes you got to yell hurt.
He's on TV, though. Mom's happy.
Second and 10. Hand off. Right side. Broken tackle. Here we go. Keyston Moore, Florida touchdown.
And a great block by Dallas Baker. That's what sprung it for the touchdown. Good blocking inside first by the offensive line. Dallas Baker made it a touchdown.
The freshman from Arlington. Fair to say the unheralded freshman who started the first two games of this season. Keyston Moore. Urban Meyer telling us, game two of the season, he's been the most dependable back that we have.
Florida not able to run very effectively on the inside, but this time, good read by Chris Lee. You see the blocking by Mike DeGore to lead it, and then Dallas Baker is going to pick two guys off on the inside, and Keyston Moore takes it into the end zone. You must have wide receivers that are willing to block. LaRon Landry got taken out, and Florida tightens the gap to 7 points.
14-7. Huge swing. Failed fourth down. A fumble. A recovery by Florida. Two plays later, 32-yard touchdown. Keyston Moore out of Arlington, Texas. First career touchdown. So no matter how this one plays out, think back to that sequence of plays that might have determined the outcome. Might.
And we called before the failed fourth down a critical juncture for the Florida season and just where they go from here. They really needed to capitalize, and they did the second time around.
Florida's had kickoff problems this year. This is their third man, Jonathan Phillips. Kicked off three times last week. This one very short, and it's taken out to the 31-yard line.
How quickly can momentum change in a game? This is fourth down. Florida elects to go for it, following the good field position. Not only stopped, but they actually lost yardage on the play. But before the offense had time to get depressed on the sideline, the defense came up with another turnover for them. And right back again, they're in great field position. They missed an incompletion on first down, second down, the run by Keyston Moore, thanks to the great block by Dallas Baker, and a total change in emotion and personality of this game in a matter of three plays.
From the 31, officially, it's first down and 10. Hand off, Joseph Addai, the man who fumbled. This time he secures the ball and gets a couple. We go back to New York. Here's Tim Brandon.
Fellas, some key points on a huge day. Vince Young with his third rushing touchdown of the half. This one from 9 yards out. It's 28-0 over Colorado. Now, a 60-yard punt return by Tom Sibakowski at Notre Dame has given them a 21-14. If this score holds up, the biggest question in college football will be, how far does Notre Dame come up or USC drop with one loss, and how many unbeatens would both of them be ahead of in the BCS poll? We'll talk about it at halftime.
Well, we've seen, you know, in the last couple weeks, teams take major jumps. We saw Alabama take a major jump after their win from against Florida, going from 15 to 8. We saw Penn State last week take a major jump. So I would say if Notre Dame holds on to beat USC, they will take a significant jump.
Injured player on the last play. That's Keaston Moore on the far side. 54 points on 18 forced turnovers this year. Will Arnold was the injured player, the left guard, and he is on the bench. Did walk off without assistance. Second down and 7. Play fake. Russell lobs it out right side. Caught by the tight end, David Jones. But a nice field tackle by Craig Steltz. Vernell Brown
with a nice tackle. And again, Vernell Brown, 5'8", 165 pounds, tackling a tight end out there who weighs close to 270. A nice form tackle in the open field, and that forces third down. And that was a big-time tackle.
And a big-time play here again in terms of getting that emotion back for LSU.
And Ray McDonald, well, he was on the field, and now he's coming back out. Oh. I think Ray wants to play. I don't think there's any doubt about that.
Third and 4. Defensively, Florida anything but set. They try the sweep, the near side, and it
stopped.
Fine defensive effort.
You know, LSU tried to sneak a normal formation, a base offensive package in there, and go with a quick count. Florida got their guys lined up quickly to stop the run, and they were able to force another punt. This is a run formation, just an I formation. No push up front, and the Florida defense, a huge stop on third down.
After they score, they force a 3-and-out, the Florida Gators. And here's Chris Jackson. Deep man is Vernell Brown. 4th and 3 with 6:42 to go, first half. Nice high and very deep. Vernell Brown drifting back, has it at the 14. Gets it back to the 17. Ronnie Prude is the injured player. Looks like he's going to be okay. Well, Mike DeGore getting a start today for the 45th consecutive game. Andrew Whitworth of LSU has started his 44th today, and that leads us to our
Aflac
trivia question. Who holds the SEC record for most consecutive games started? On first down and 10. Deshaun Wynn.
All of a sudden, a little spunk in the Gator offense on the inside run. And it starts with this. This spread option starts with an inside read on the zone play. And if the defensive alignment and pursuit tells Chris Leak to keep the ball in the belly of the running back, that's what he does first. We've seen a couple plays here in the second quarter where they've gotten some good push up front, and either Deshaun Wynn or Keaston Moore with a nice run.
No team has rushed for more than 100 yards against LSU this year. Well, that 32-yard run, big help. Here's Leak. He falls down at the 24-yard line. It's going to set up third down. Louisiana State's defense, second in the country against the rush. Bo Pelini's unit, they were torched in the first game passing-wise by Arizona State, but those yards have gone down every game since.
Yeah, it really has. And you got to remember this about LSU also. They had two corners last year that started for 3 years for Nick Saban's defense. Bo Pelini inherits a lot of good interior guys, but two new corners in Ronnie Prude and Chevis Jackson, and they've gotten better each week.
3rd and 5. Blitz. Cameron Vaughn coming. And a good read by Leak, but excellent pursuit by LSU will force a Florida punt. Chad Jackson makes the catch.
But they just still have not really been able to threaten that LSU defense with their wide receivers. They got the one big run in there, but Chris Leak only 5 of 15, but only 29 yards of passing offense. And these wide receivers, who are the playmakers for the Florida Gators, pretty much non-factors here in the first half, other than the block by Dallas Baker. That was a big play.
Yep. 6th punt already. Eric Wilbur. Skylar Green, fair catch. Makes the grab at the 33-yard line. Monday on a new CSI Miami, three investigators come up with three different conclusions. Can you figure out which one is right? Find out on Monday's number one show, CSI Miami, right here on CBS, America's most watched network. First and 10, Louisiana State. Had the North Texas State game postponed, or they'll be playing them next.
The 29th. They play Auburn next.
I'm sorry.
And then it'll be North Texas.
Chiron Carey is in the backfield. Russell, deep right side. Benny Brazell, man for man with Vernell Brown.
Good no call. That's a good no call. He's in good position. He has a right to that position. And Benny Brazell, who's already caught a touchdown pass today, I mean, he's not a polished receiver. I mean, he's a speed guy who you want to throw the deep ball to, but he didn't really have a good feel for how to get himself uncovered. I mean, here's the matchup over here, Brown and Brazell, and Vernell Brown's in good position to play defense there.
Athlete second down and 10. Auburn is coming in here next week. Have you seen a team in recent years that's so under the radar as Auburn?
They are completely under the radar. And the thing about it is, they were written off after their opening loss to Georgia Tech, but I think they're as good as anybody in the SEC. And their quarterback, Brandon Cox, is getting better and better.
Fake the screen, now lob it up. Whoa. Well, he did throw that.
Now the penalty's coming down because Jamarcus Russell was not outside of the tackle box and he threw it away. I think it's going to be intentional grounding.
Jarvis Moss with the penetration at a Florida player down. Steven Harris is the injured player. Right defensive tackle.
I'm interested in what this call is because...
Actually, two flags I see. There's one up at the 33-yard line. And then one back at the 14. Terry Brown's going to straighten that out while Stephen Harris gets a little medical attention.
You know, we were talking a little bit about Auburn. If you look at the SEC statistics, they're up there in everything. They are leading the SEC in scoring offense and scoring defense. And again, they've got a new quarterback this year. And Brandon Cox, who's getting better and better. But defensively, I think they're as good as anybody in the league.
There's two flags on the play. We're going to disregard the first flag for ineligible receiver downfield. The second flag is for intentional grounding against the offense number four. Number four was not outside the pocket prior to throwing the pass. He was not outside the pocket. That is a spot foul, also loss of down. Third down.
He has to get outside of this mark here to make that throw, and he never does. If he gets past the tackle box and throws it away, as long as it crosses the line of scrimmage, you can do that. But if you stay in there and make that throw, they're going to call it. Harris is the guy who gets hit right here. Kind of wasn't expecting the contact, but he's going off the field. Looks like he's going to be okay.
And it brings up third down and a ton. Third and 29 for LSU.
And with 3:55 left, a stop here by Florida, and they should get the ball back again with excellent field position. And one timeout before halftime.
Jarvis Moss had the pressure on the last play.
But Jarvis Moss is a great story. It's great to see him back playing and healthy and contributing to this Florida defense.
Here's the handoff. They'll keep it on the ground, and Joseph Addai comes near side out to the 28-yard line. Make it Vernell Brown, and that will force an LSU punt. So Florida, with one timeout remaining, has 3 minutes and 47 seconds to go first half. Jarvis Moss, Todd alluded to, he had an infection in his pelvic bone. Took them almost 2 years to discover what the problem was. Turns out it was the after effect of a cortisone shot when he was a senior in high school in Denton, Texas. And finally, they took a biopsy in the beginning of this summer. He was down to 217 pounds. They found out what it was, antibiotics for 6 weeks. He's back to 247 and playing well. Off the side of his foot, but it keeps Vernell Brown from returning it. The Chicago Tribune calls Threshold the most exciting new show of the TV season. Find out why on an all-new episode this Friday on CBS, America's Most Watched Network.
Is the Chicago Tribune, is that like an official television show raider? I'm wondering if I can get the Canton Repository as one of our promos.
Well, only if you'll give equal time to the Steamboat Springs pilot. We've got a critic in Steamboat Springs. Awesome. First down and 10. Leak wants it all. Goes deep for Dallas Baker into double coverage, and this one just beyond the fingertips, and terrific coverage from Jesse Daniels.
Jesse Daniels, Ronnie Prude, double coverage there, and I'm glad that they challenged him, though. That's the first time Chris Leak has really set his feet and made a strong throw down the field. But great coverage by both of those LSU defenders. We just haven't seen any Florida wide receivers running open in space today.
LSU goes with the nickel defense now. Jonathan Zenon hurries on. Here's the handoff to Sean Wynn across the 40. Out to the 44-yard line. Well, what's going on around the SEC? Huge win today. Alabama with a field goal. Jamie Christensen at the end of the game. They go 6-0. Auburn, 12 straight SEC games. That is the fourth longest streak since 1992. Auburn is here next week. Alabama at home against Tennessee. And this game's so critical for both of these teams because they're both chasing somebody. Florida chasing Georgia, LSU chasing Alabama. And they both play those respective teams. Yeah. Fumble, Leak. Drops on it at the 35 with Cameron Vaughn there to make sure he doesn't get up.
Well, we saw Chris Leak slip trying to run the ball a couple plays ago. This time he just drops the ball. He's got his eyes on Cameron Vaughn before he secures the snap. And because of that, he has to just fall on it and prevent the fumble.
So Leak dons the headsets. Here's the punt, the seventh by Eric Wilbert, and it chases Skylar Green way over to the right. And
he's doing a great job.
Boy, he sure has.
You know, whether they've done the rugby kick or the straight punt, he has done a great job of kicking it away from Skylar Green.
49-yard punt, nothing on the return, and time now for the answer to the
Aflac
trivia question of the week, which was, who holds the record for consecutive SEC games started? And the answer is... David Green.
Also the winningest quarterback in NCAA history, David Green.
I saw him this summer. He's now on the Seattle Seahawks roster as the third quarterback. He was so excited because he looked at their schedule, and the off week for the Seahawks coincides with the Georgia-Florida game. David's going to be there. Yep. Joseph Addai, the running back, first down. Gets the handoff, goes right, spilled at the 21-yard line. Under 2 minutes to go, first half. 14-7, two touchdown throws from Jamarcus Russell. A touchdown run from Keaston Moore for Florida. 14-7, second and five.
Well, fans are booing a little bit here because Les Miles looks like he's going to be content to go in at 14-7. That play had a chance of busting it for a huge run. And Addai just tripped up. If they would have got a big run there, they might have been a little more aggressive here at the end of the half.
LSU has two timeouts left. They keep it on the ground. And the crowd doesn't like it. Jimbo Fisher calls the plays for LSU. Jimbo Fisher electing to not go with Nick Saban down to the Miami Dolphins. He remained here as the offensive coordinator.
I don't think this is a bad move at all. I mean, your team has controlled the first half. You've led the entire game. You've turned it over twice, and both of them have been costly. Why take another chance at giving Florida some momentum going into halftime?
Of course, the memories here.
Oh, yeah.
They're thinking, I'm sure, Tennessee. LSU was up 21-0 at the half and wound up losing 30-27. There's across the middle, Joseph Addai. Now we'll see, 41 seconds, there's a flag down at the line of scrimmage.
Well, they've got all three timeouts, so if they want to take a shot now after that big play, they've got three timeouts to work with.
Looks like a guy
coming out of the backfield, just a little option route to the inside. Joseph Addai does a little bit of everything. He runs the ball, he protects, catches.
Offsides on the defense, number 20. The penalty is declined. The results of the play, first down.
Joe Cohen. And that is a 20-yard game that negates the offside by number 20.
I think they will be aggressive now. Now that they're out by midfield, you've got two timeouts, I think they'll be a little more aggressive here.
Out of the spread, Jamarcus Russell. Florida brings four, and one of whom gets
a fumble. That's a fumble.
Ball's loose. Florida's got it. Jarvis Moss, number 94.
I think.
Enormous turnover.
Jamarcus Russell not aware that the pressure was coming from Moss, and Moss just goes right up high. That's what you want to do. If he hits him low, Russell's so big and strong, he holds on to this football. But because he hit him up around the shoulder, that ball popped out, and Florida got the football back.
One timeout for the Gators, 26 seconds to go. That's the third fumble now by LSU in the first half.
Just like last week, three first-half turnovers kept that game closer than it should have been.
Leak out of the spread. DeGore will snap it back. Now the change. Three wide left, one wide right. That's Dallas Baker. Baker, slant pattern, inside, overthrown, had him. Ronnie Prude defending.
Well, it looks like, you know, Chad Jackson came out of the game last week. He was bothered a little bit with a knee injury, tweaked it in the game. We knew Jamel Cornelius was out with the ankle. And it looks like those two guys are just not really part of the plan today. The only guy they've tried to get the football to consistently has been Dallas Baker. And those other guys, if they're healthy, they need to step up and make some plays from the wide receiver position.
21 seconds to go. Blitz coming from LSU. Leak steps up. He's being chased by Chase Pittman, appropriately enough, and he is knocked down as he lets the ball go. Incomplete. Third and 10. Now Chris Hetland is the field goal kicker for the Florida Gators for the season. Perfect 7 of 7. And target line is the 29-yard line. Third and 10. Kenneth Tukes and Chad Jackson go wide left. Baker and Deshaun Wynn are near side. That's Wynn going into the backfield. And LSU looks like they might be coming. They are. They blitz. And Leak is caught and dropped.
And dropped way out of field goal range.
Allie Highsmith.
And see, this shouldn't have happened. I'm not sure what happened because LSU brought six, but because Florida brought Deshaun Wynn back into the backfield, that gave them six blockers. If you have six blocking, you should be able to block six rushing. They only blocked five, and they got no shot at the field goal. There's only five rushers. Chase Pittman didn't even come. Five against six, LSU won and stopped the field goal attempt.
Halftime with a score 14-7. Ready for a conversation with Urban Meyer, and it's presented by Charles Schwab. Here's Tracy.
Thanks, guys. Coach, down just seven, but Chris Leake still struggling out there. Yeah. How do you get him going in the second half?
Well, we're
going
to settle him down, and they're blitzing a lot. They're blitzing our empty, no back passing attack. So we got to settle down. We got to get guys open too. So I think it's a combination. Chris is struggling, but we got to get some receivers get open.
How about the way your defense has kept you in this game so far?
Defense is playing well, and you know what? We're running the ball decent. We just got to loading up the box. We got to be able to make some plays throwing the ball.
Thanks a lot. Good luck.
Thanks, Tracy. That's the end of the first half here with the score 14-7, Louisiana State. Let's go to Tim Brando in our New York studio.
Thank you, Vern. Coming up on the GEICO Halftime Report, I'll have all of today's scores and highlights, including dramatic comebacks and an update on the latest game of the century after this message and a word from your local station.
LSU leads by 7 at halftime. We're set for the third quarter, but first, let's go down to Tracy for an SEC moment presented by Sonic.
Vern, in 1997, Florida came into Baton Rouge riding a 25-game conference win streak, but it would end here in Tiger Stadium after Herb Tyler touchdown run. The Tigers intercepted 4 Doug Johnson passes, returning 1-4 score. The Gators' aura of invincibility was smashed, and the Tigers celebrated another memorable night in Death Valley. We now want to take this time to honor one of our own. On Tuesday, our friend and colleague, Vern Lundquist, will be inducted into the Texas Sports Hall of Fame. Vern began his illustrious career at KTPC TV in Austin, Texas. Beginning in 1977, he won 7 consecutive Texas Sportscaster of the Year awards. He is one of 8 broadcasters and writers being inducted. Vern, congratulations from all of us. You deserve it. Todd, give him a big hug.
Absolutely. All right. Group hug here for everybody.
You guys got me with that one. You know, I'm compelled to point out that I wore the glasses that automatically tint in daylight. I know better than to think that I'm Mr. Cool. Shades and all, thank you, guys. We'll be right back. ...14-7 LSU, and they will get the ball to begin the second half. Vern Lundquist, Todd Blackledge, Tracy Wolfson at Tiger Stadium. A record-setting crowd today. 92,000 plus, largest crowd ever in the history of Tiger Stadium. Jonathan Phillips to kick off. Skylar Green grabs it a yard deep, and he'll come out. All the way out to the 28-yard line. So this LSU team that lost the ball on 3 fumbles in the first half goes on offense, Todd. They lead 14-7. It's still a very tight game, obviously. What are keys for both?
Well, I think it's very simple. I think for LSU, they've got to hold on to the football better. I mean, they passed it, they ran it, but they couldn't hold on to the football. 3 turnovers. And for Florida, they've got to throw and catch better. I mean, that, you know, for as uncomfortable as Chris Leake might be with the option aspects of this offense, he shouldn't be uncomfortable dropping back and throwing the football. And these wide receivers are supposed to be the strength. Just like Urban Meyer said, they've got to get guys get open, and he's got to throw the football better in the second half.
Here's the toss on first down to Adai. He comes left, doesn't get much. And the halftime statistics presented by State Farm. Turnovers 3-0. Rushing yards modest for both. Passing yards, LSU with the edge.
I mean, Florida's not going to beat anybody throwing the ball for 29 yards. I mean, Chris Leake was 5 of 18. And they're very fortunate to be only down 7 right now because of the LSU turnovers. So a whole half of football to make those corrections. Ray McDonald in the game now again for Florida. Playing a little bit more than we thought. They've got him inside. They kept Mincy and Jarvis Moss in to rush the passer. He's inside with Marcus Thomas.
Jamarcus Russell back on second down. Flag, this one's going to come back. That's in the area of holding. Jamarcus Russell out of bounds at the 39-40-yard line. And let's check in once again with Tracy Wolfson. Trace.
Thanks, Vern. Well, speaking of those LSU turnovers, word from the sideline is Les Miles in the locker room stressed fundamentals. He said, watch the QB running back exchange. Be sure of your reads. He said, we shot ourselves in our foot and let them back into it.
Well, I would agree.
Yep.
And the flag will cost them on this one. Holding LSU. So it wipes out a first down run from Jamarcus Russell. 5th penalty.
And you can see Charlie Strong and Greg Madison, the two defensive coordinators for Florida, very judicious in their use of Ray McDonald. He's only been in a few plays when they're anticipating pass, but he's been pretty effective combining with those other guys up front.
Second down and 20. Charlie Strong, who was with the staff of Ron Zook as the defensive coordinator, asked to stay on as a co-coordinator with Greg Madison by Urban Meyer. Here's Russell back, blitz coming, and he avoids the blitz. Now can he get rid of the ball? Boy, he takes a belt and throws it up for grabs. It's intercepted at the 46.
The first very poor decision we've seen from Jamarcus Russell. His strength got him away from the blitz. He should have been sacked in the pocket, but because he's so big and strong, he got away from that. Brandon Seiler may have got away with a hit to the helmet, but at the end of the play, if you're going to throw it away, throw it all the way out of bounds. Throw it up in the third row. Don't throw it right there on the sideline where it can get intercepted.
Fourth, LSU turnover. Forced turnovers in 6.5 games by Florida now. They are plus 12 for the season. 4-0 in this game. Jarvis Herring got the interception. Now he puts it on the shoulders of Chris Leak, who is only 5 of 18. They'll hand it off to Wynn, who's got a lot of room. Chased by Jesse Daniels, but he's got a first down at the 10-yard line.
Boy, they really changed him up on this run. Normally this run hits inside. This was designed to go outside. And they sealed the end. Watch this run by Deshaun Wynn. Here he is, and they're going to seal this end of it. Melvin Oliver gets double teamed, and nobody outside. Look at that outside clearance for Deshaun Wynn. Nobody had outside leverage. Good block outside by the wide receiver, and Florida inside the 10-yard line.
Leak out of the spread. First and goal. Chris Leak dumped.
What a disastrous play. You Chase get the Pittman. Huge run, and then there was all mixed up. I don't know who was wrong, but there was no pitch man, and that's why Chris Leak went down, because there was no option to the option.
And so, second and goal, 16 yards out. Loss of 6. Empty backfield again. 3 down for LSU defensively. They've got 4 on the line, and they will bring 4. Leak steps up, looks for blocking help, gets it on Allie Highsmith, and he skips out of bounds at the 5-yard line. Ronnie Prude with a tackle, a gain of 10.
Well, I like what I'm seeing out of Dallas Baker this season. I mean, he's a guy, another one of those guys at Florida that they expected to be a great wide receiver right away. Big, tall, rangy guy. And he has really started to come on the last 3 weeks. And not only as a receiver, but being a complete football player. That was another great block that got Leak down by the 5-yard line.
Look at Chris Leak jumping up and down. Third and goal at the 5. Empty backfield again. 4-man LSU rush. Leak avoids the tackle down at the 5. And let's see if we see the field goal unit. I'm sure we will. I can't imagine that they would.
Yeah, you got to get points here. I mean, you can't close the gap a little bit. Your defense is playing well. Put points on the board and put the pressure back on LSU's offense.
Chris Hetland, junior out of Leesburg, Georgia. 7 of 7 for the season, and this one from 22 yards out. Nick Fleming will hold. Cuts it inside the left upright. Interception followed by a 36-yard Deshaun Wynn run and a 22-yard field goal. It's 14-10.
14-10. Florida changing the momentum of the game and have yet to have a good pass play for any kind of big yards. All their big plays have come from the running game, but they're only down 4 as we start the third.
The Home Depot SEC on CBS is sponsored by GEICO. Singular. Miller Lite. And by Pontiac.
Back in Tiger Stadium, Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Jonathan Phillips set to kick off as Florida has scored 10 unanswered now on either side of the halftime break. That last drive highlight was a 36-yard DeSean Wynn run.
Last time that Florida kicked off to start the second half, a poor kickoff, not very deep. Again, they've tried to directional kick the whole game. Phillips needs to get a better one here.
Green and Adai are the deep men. This will be Skylar Green. He moves up and takes it at the five. Flag is down at the 30-yard line. Tomorrow, an exclusive first look at Scott Pelley's 60-minute interview with Bill Romanowski. It's all tomorrow on the NFL Today. Always first on the field. That'll be a preview of a 60 Minutes piece. Tomorrow, 12 noon Eastern time. There's the call.
During the return, holding on the return team, number 18. Phil has half the distance to the goal. First down.
Jacob Hester. There are the turnovers, you see, and that is the sixth penalty on LSU. Les Miles, 51 years old, graduate of the University of Michigan. Head coach Oklahoma State the last 3 years. Prior to that, on the staff of the Dallas Cowboys. 3 years as a tight end coach there. Said he welcomed the high expectations of a high-profile program like LSU. He thought that was a positive, not a negative. Here's the handoff. Adai trying to skip outside. Grinnell Brown is up there to help make the stop at the 10-yard line. 14-10, two early touchdowns on throws from Jamarcus Russell gave LSU a 14-0 lead. Florida came back with a 32-yard Keaston Moore touchdown run before halftime, and they just had an interception that led to a field goal. So as we play here early third quarter, 14-10 LSU.
You remember in that Tennessee loss, they were winning 21-0, and when Tennessee started to come back in the second half, they got a little conservative calling plays.
Here's Russell with a play fake, rolls right, and he'll keep it. Now to the 16-yard line. That'll bring up a third down as Earl Everett makes the tackle, and let's go back to New York and check in with Tim.
Vern, I need to know if Tracy and Todd need to be separated when discussing this one. Michigan has won six in a row over Penn State. Michael Hart takes it in from 2 yards out. Hart is headed for a 100-yard rushing day. They've gotten to the fourth. It's 10-3 Michigan, Vern.
Oh, no, so Tracy smiling, yeah. Todd is not. And I am in a sense of great anticipation awaiting the Texas Lutheran University score.
It's going to be a little bit further down the scroll today, I think.
Well, after that narrow defeat to East Texas Baptist, what can you expect? LSU is going to use timeout. Boy, you just get a sense, Todd, that old Mo has gone toward Florida. Things are really flat for the LSU Tigers. They do have a 4-point lead, but they've taken some shots from the Florida defense. There are a few Florida fans here. Cheerleading squad made the trip from Gainesville, urging their team on, and we're back to play with LSU looking at third down and four at the 16-yard line. Adai, the running back. Blitz threatened from the corner. Here comes Reggie Nelson. Inside they go. Benny Brazell, first down out to the 25-yard line.
The big throw for Jamarcus Russell. You called it right before the break. It just seemed like things had gone flat here for LSU. They needed the conversion on third down. Russell read the pressure, knew he had enough time to make that quick slant throw. And Brazell, who had the touchdown catch to start the game, a huge catch there on third down.
Benny Brazell, two catches, 52 yards. First down and 10 at the 25-yard line. Backs in the eye. and Bo starts in motion. Play fake again. Russell, pressure from the backside. They got him down.
He didn't try to throw it that time, though. You know, sometimes the defense wins, and I think that Greg Maddison and Charlie Strong are saying, you know what? When we anticipate pass, we got to go after this guy a little bit more. We've got to put pressure on him. And Reggie Nelson is their primary blitz guy from the secondary. Here he is. He's going to come in on the blitz on the outside. They also bring a linebacker inside. That's Seiler. And Nelson doesn't get the sack, but he forced Jamarcus Russell to pull that ball down and start to run. And a good decision to bring a little more heat on Jamarcus Russell.
See Greg Maddison and Charlie Strong, the co-coordinators, second down and 20. Third sack of Jamarcus Russell. Here's a dive. Bolts up the middle. Big gain.
It'll just be short
of the first down.
And you know who makes the tackle? Reggie Nelson. I mean, this guy is an outstanding football player. He's a junior college transfer who only played 1 year of junior college. Here he is backing out, showing blitz. Now he's going to come from across the formation and make a solid tackle on a big back to stop him short of the first down. If he doesn't make a good tackle there, that's a first down for LSU, and they've got momentum back.
Reggie Nelson at Coffeyville Community College in Kansas last year, 6 interceptions, 4 punt returns for touchdowns. It's 3rd and 1. Backs in the eye again, double tight end set, the pitch out near side. Great pursuit on a dive.
Where did he step out? That's going to be
Jarvis Herring. Let's see.
It looks like he's short.
Wow.
We've seen back-to-back outstanding tackles by defensive backs. Watch Herring tackle Adai high. If he goes low, Adai goes right over top of him and dives for the first down. But because he hit him up in the chest area, he wasn't able to get past the first down marker before his foot stepped out of bounds. Back-to-back plays, defensive backs excellent.
How about this, Les Miles? 4th and 1.
I think they're just going to try to get him to jump off sides.
Okay.
And you see Charlie Strong saying, watch the ball. Don't give up the penalty. I'll be surprised if they go for this.
At the 34-yard line. How about that? Left side, he got it.
Wow.
How about that? Les Miles rolls the dice and comes up big. Now that took some courage.
Yes, it did.
I'm thinking of a different phrase, but
yeah, right. I know which phrase you're thinking of, and he showed him. I'll tell you, because I did not think. I thought they just tried to draw the penalty. Jarvis Herring up there and knowing when the run was coming, but a big gamble by Les Miles, and that might get this crowd back in the game too. You know, showing that gamble and getting the first down again, get the crowd back in.
Now Russell back, goes deep left side. Early Doucette, man for man, catches made out of bounds. Defended by Kyle Jackson, number 3. Remember what we said about no matter how it plays out, that sequence in the second quarter was going to be critical.
Well, it started with the fourth down try by Florida, where they missed. But they got the ball right back on the fumble. And then they get the touchdown run off of that to get on the scoreboard. And then they've kind of chipped away at it ever since then. Now, LSU had 176 yards of offense in the first quarter. Very little since then. Under 50 yards since then. But that fourth down gamble there was important.
See early Doucette limping as he goes back to the sidelines. Not back on the field on 2nd and 10. Adai, another big hole. Huge run out near the 50-yard line. Tackle made by Kyle Jackson. That's a gain of 13.
Well, rather than go with 2 tight ends and try to power run, they spread them out with 4 wide receivers. They bring the tackle around on a little tackle trap play. That's Brian Johnson, number 75. Spread out the defense and then run the football up inside. Joseph Adai, nice job there.
He gets a rest now. Chiron Carey is on. Adai just a yard short of his 3rd 100-yard game of the season. 1st down and 10. We've not seen Justin Vincent since a fumble. And here's a big run by Carey and a flag down at the 50-yard line, line of scrimmage.
Boy, another costly penalty. You know, a lot of times when you see a side of a defense collapse like that, you can anticipate a penalty.
Yet another holding call.
And the way Andrew Whitworth is gyrating down there. It looks like it was the second one called on him.
Turn to run, holding on the offense, number 76. Penalty is 10 yards from the spot of the foul. Replay, first down.
It's the second time a good run by LSU has been called back on a holding on this guy, Andrew Whitworth, their best offensive lineman, having an outstanding season. Blocking on Jarvis Moss. Well, I don't know. I mean, he did have his hands on the shoulder pads, but he had his hands pretty far inside, and he turned him. You know, the old adage, of course, I'm a son of an offensive line coach. that old adage about you can call holding on every play, that's true. I thought he did pretty good job that time.
A little look of exasperation from Andrew Whitworth, making his 44th consecutive start today. Second down, first down and 19. Here's Russell with time across the middle, caught by the tight end. Keith Singer, number 89. That's a gain of 11. We're getting to the point. First BCS standings are going to be released here shortly. USC still trailing Notre Dame, 21-14. Texas winning big. Virginia Tech with a bye week. Seminoles play tonight. Georgia at Vandy tonight. And Alabama just did escape in Oxford. Last second field goal from 22 yards out, Jamie Christensen. Miami wins, Penn State trailing. Second down and 8 here in a 14-10 game. Doucette back on the field. Gets the handoff and goes right, cuts it up to the 45-yard line. Early Doucette, the sophomore, St. Martinsville, Louisiana. Now thinking back to these guys had the first game postponed, the second game switched to Arizona State. Finally got the Monday night game against Tennessee up 21-0, and they lost in the overtime. And the critics really came out here about Les Miles. And he was really taking some vocal abuse on radio talk shows in this state, in large part because Nick Saban was such a rock star here. And I want to continue that in just a second. Here's a third down. Jamarcus Russell back. Oh, boy. It is picked off. Joe Cohen. It was hit first by Stephen Harris and then intercepted by Joe Cohen. 5 LSU turnovers.
Wow. It just looked like Jamarcus Russell thought he had an easy throw for the first down, trying to slip it inside to his tight end, David Jones. Stephen Harris comes on a little stunt and then drops off, and the ball just goes right to him. He's not able to control it, but he's able to keep it alive enough for Joe Cohen to come up with it. Jamarcus Russell never saw Stephen Harris crossing into the throwing lane. Unbelievable.
And Joe Cohen, the defensive end, former fullback.
Yep, former fullback. Soft hands.
Yes, indeed. Gets the interception on the deflection. His first. First and 10, Gators. Leak.
Throwback.
There's the screen. Wide open. Deshaun Wynn knocked out of bounds by Cameron Vaughn inside the 15.
The first time they've been able to get a decent play out of their passing game. And it's a little bit of a trick play, but they haven't been able to get it any other way. Chris Leak is going to roll this way. Deshaun Wynn's going to slip out here, and nobody picks him up. You see Chase Pittman chasing the play, and a nice wall set out there for Deshaun Wynn. They haven't been able to throw that screen to the wide receiver, but they got the throw back to the running back.
Plus 13 in turnovers, and LSU with 5 lost today. Now goes to minus 6. Here are flags.
Prior to snap, false start on the offense, number 79. Penalty is 5 yards. Remains first down.
Steve Risler. Joe Cohen, teammate of Mike DeGore and Reggie Nelson in Melbourne, Florida. Latrell Alford blocking our view of him.
And Xavier Carter, the right receiver for LSU, also played at Palm Bay High School.
First and 15 at the 17. Gators trail by 4. Deshaun Wynn to the 5. Wow. Down at the 1.
Great read by Chris Leak on the inside run. Credit Mike DeGore and those guards in there, too. Makes the read. Chase Pittman plays soft, so let the fullback run it. And a nice running lane in there. Tavares Washington, the left guard, leading the way. And a good hard-nose run by Deshaun Wynn.
LaRon Landry with the tackle. Deshaun Wynn 90 yards. He's caught a pass for 19. It's first and goal, Florida. They can get the first lead, their first lead of the ball game. Let's go, the fullback. Deshaun Wynn strolls in, touchdown. Gators are in front for the first time.
Inside three, the center, the two guards blocking on the inside runs, and Deshaun Wynn with his seventh touchdown of the season.
Extra point. Chris Hetland up and good. And with 4 minutes and 2 seconds remaining in the third quarter, helped in no small part by five LSU turnovers, Deshaun Wynn's 1 yard touchdown romp has given Florida a 3-point lead. Eastern time. 17 unanswered now. Jamarcus Russell and his team falling behind 17 to 14. And a sense of unease among this crowd of better than 92,000.
What do you think they must be feeling right now? I mean, they watched their team give up a 21-point lead in the last home game.
Here's a very poor kick by Jonathan Phillips and a fair catch called at the 25-yard line. Catch made by Luke Sanders.
You know, Deshaun Wynn's touchdown run was easy, but I want you to watch this run as it develops. Watch the blocking on the inside defensive tackles. Mike DeGore right there on Kyle Williams. Here's Claude Roten being blocked, the middle linebacker being blocked. I mean, that is an outstanding hole for Deshaun Wynn to run through. Great execution on the inside run by the Florida offensive line. The offensive line has been much maligned this year, giving up a lot of sacks, haven't been able to open up running holes. Great job that time.
First down 10, LSU, early to set. Here's the toss. They're coming near side. Stelts, the fullback, out to lead the way as Joseph Addai gets out to the 31-yard line. Brandon Seiler makes the tackle. Before this goes away, I want to finish that thought that we were talking about just before the interception. Nick Saban called Michael Bennett, a member of the LSU administration this week. They were talking about the Miles criticism. And Nick Saban said, those people apparently forgot that we lost at home to UAB my first year. They did.
Yep.
They lost here on homecoming, and that gave them a 2-2 record. The next week, they beat Tennessee. Then they lost to Florida. So in Nick Saban's first season, they were sitting at 3-3.
Well, just to follow up on that as well, I mean, aside the fact of losing a game, how quickly did the people forget what this man had to lead his team and his staff through in his first year on the job here? I mean, nobody could have ever possibly anticipated the turmoil and everything that went on, was associated with Hurricane Katrina, and how it affected this football team. Obviously, it affected a lot of people all over the place, but they had players whose families they weren't in contact with for days, and a lot of emotional issues going on with players on the team in addition to trying to prepare to play.
Third down and 3. LSU trailing by 3. Russell back. Fires it. Caught. Tight end David Jones. Big play. First down.
I like seeing that from Jamarcus. You know, you got to be able to shake off those bad plays. You got to be able to shake off the bad decision. David Jones is the tight end right here. Just a little out route. You don't need much for the first down. Get open into a space, and Jamarcus, set your feet and make a good strong throw, and he did. Slipped it right in there by Earl Everett.
First down and 10. Russell, 11 of 18 for 190 yards, has been picked off twice, once by Herring, once by Joe Cohen. Addai and Stelts are in the backfield behind Jamarcus Russell. Play action, blitz from the corner. Russell shakes that tackle from Jerome Mincy, goes deep and throws it away.
That one away for sure. I mean, that one he didn't leave back in the field of play.
Mincy missed the tackle. Turnovers today.
Well, 5 of them. You know, you talk about shooting yourself in the foot. This is using a howitzer to do it. I mean, they have just not been careful with the football. And yet they had the lead for most of the game until just recently. And those turnovers catch up. This last one led to the go-ahead touchdown. But Jamarcus Russell with a couple big throws here trying to put the memory of that last interception as far away from as he can.
Second down and 10. Double tight end set. Hand it off. Adai looks for blocking help. Works on his own. After the 47, let's check in with Tracy Wolfson. Tracy.
Thanks, guys. Well, after that last turnover, LSU coaches trying to keep this LSU offense positive. They were saying, keep your poise. We're still in this game. We have to keep it going. A lot of players also coming up to Jamarcus Russell after that last interception to make sure he stays positive as well.
Oh, yeah, there's so much time left and a lot of football left to be played in this game.
Under 90 seconds to go, third quarter. It's third and six. 17-14 Gators. Stunts and a blitz by Florida. Early Doucette makes the grab. That's
very close
to the first down.
All going to depend on the spot.
Yep.
And it's looking like he's getting a
left foot spot.
Yeah.
Well, is that good or bad?
Well, no, I think he would have wanted a left foot spot here. I think he's getting a right one.
Ah, that's not good.
You know, he turned very awkwardly to make this catch. It was thrown almost like a hot read, but it really didn't need to be a hot throw, and he got spun around making the catch.
Early Doucette, a six-footer, 19-year-old sophomore from St. Martinville, Louisiana, still down at the 48-yard line.
While we're waiting here, I mean, this brings up another situation. Fourth and very short. Les Miles has already gone for it once on fourth and one. This time they're on the other side of the 50. I would expect they'll go for it again.
Early Doucette out. Fourth and less than a yard.
Fourth and less than one, if you got any room right over the center and your quarterback weighs 250 pounds, you should be able to sneak this for a first down.
And they come up and plug it, and Louisiana State, for the second time in the third quarter, has a first and 10. That gives us a moment to go back and check in once again with Tim in New York.
Vern, this is amazing. Penn State had tied the game on a Michael Robinson touchdown, and then Chad Henne of Michigan has the ball ripped away by Alan Zamaitis. It's a fumble recovery for 35 yards and a score. Then on the extra point, heads up play by Kevin Kelly on the bad snap. The kicker gets a 2-point conversion. He got 15 points in 17 seconds.
Oh, I wish you could see. It's not even a smile. It's a cat-like grin on the face of Mr. Blackledge.
Well, what you don't know, partner, is that Miss Wolfson and I have a little wager in this game. And
yes,
the loser has to sing the fight song of the winning team next week in the production meeting. So
I think I can wait for that.
Don't want to sing Hail to the Victors.
I think we can all wait for that. That'll be it for three here. Jerome Mincy getting new shoes on the sideline. That's the end of the third quarter with the score 17-14. Got something broiling here in Death Valley. We'll return to Baton Rouge right after this word from your local station. So we begin the fourth quarter before a crowd of 92,402, largest ever in Tiger Stadium. And the LSU Tigers begin the fourth with a second down and six at the 40-yard line, trailing by three. Vern Lundquist, Todd Blackledge, Tracy Wolfson. The handoff, a dive, short. It's going to be third down and short for LSU again. And Todd, we talked about it at the very beginning of the day, the significance of this ball game for both of these teams.
You know, and it's playing out the way that I thought. I mean, both teams are showing tremendous guts and effort. Both defenses have really bowed their necks and played well. I knew it would be a defensive game. Turnovers have killed LSU. A lack of ability to throw the football has hurt Florida, but Florida has the lead right now. LSU with a nice drive. I think in the last 15 minutes, something in the kicking game is going to turn this game, is going to decide the outcome.
Five turnovers for LSU so far. Third and four here, and they're down by three. Donald Jones sets up tight to the right side, backs in the eye. Adai is the deep back. Now Stelz moves over and flags fly.
I don't know if they got this play off in time. And this could be as
huge,
costly a penalty as they've had today. Third down and
four.
Three.
Prior to the snap, delay of game.
Now third and eight.
Four.
That's huge.
5 yards. Remains third down.
We talked about the progress Jamarcus has made as a game manager, but that was a careless mistake by the young quarterback.
Eighth penalty of the ball game against LSU. You couple that with five turnovers and
absolutely.
Wow.
And see, coming into the game, Florida, if they got you third and seven or more, they only allowed 10% conversion rate. They just went from third and three to third and eight. That's a big difference against this defense.
Neiswanger snaps it back. Three-man rush. They drop eight. Jamarcus Russell has, whoa, wide open. Oh, my goodness. Dwayne Bowe in the middle of the field.
And this goes against general teaching for a quarterback. You never tell a quarterback, don't throw the ball late in the middle. But because Bowe is 6'3 and knows how to go up and get the ball at the height of his jump, he makes the play. Kyle Jackson was there in position, but Bowe timed his jump and caught it at the height. Man.
31 yards. They needed nine. Adai and Stelz in the backfield. In the eye once again. That's Zinger going to the left, the tight end. Doss, Adai, 5 yard line. Down at the three.
Great block in there by Brian Johnson, number 75. Leading that play. That's power football right there. Two tight ends just running power football. Stelz, the fullback, leading. Livings and Brian Johnson on the right side, sticking on their blocks.
Second and one at the three.
Give it to him again.
And they will. He tries to bounce it to the outside. Touchdown, Tigers. And they reclaim the lead.
The first two scores for LSU were the results of big pass plays. This was an impressive touchdown drive for LSU. Converted on third down. Converted on fourth down. Ran it. Threw it. Recaptured the lead.
Big day for Joseph Adai. Colt David for the extra point. Matt Flynn, the backup quarterback, is the holder. High snap from Gant Petty, but brought down nicely by Matt Fleming.
LSU, power football. Joseph Adai, the dependable one. Tigers back on top.
And now, it's time for our Geico scoring recap.
Here's the score.
With Mike the Tiger looking on, it was all LSU early. A couple of touchdown tosses from Jamarcus Russell. The first to Benny Brazell, and the second to Dwayne Bowe. That gave LSU a 14-0 lead. Keaston Moore from 32 yards out cut the margin to 14-7. That's where we were at the half. A Chris Hetland field goal narrowed it even more, 14-10. And then Florida took the lead at Deshaun Wynn's scamper of a yard. They were up 17-14. And a moment ago, Joseph Adai, who has now run for 124 yards on 24 carries, put Louisiana State back on top.
And what a drive that was for LSU. 12 plays, 75 yards, almost 6.5 minutes off the clock. They converted two third down plays, critical plays, one fourth down. They overcome the penalty on the delay of game and still connect on the third down play. That was all good for LSU.
Chris Jackson will kick off. Gavin Dickey and Marcus Manson are the deep men. This is Manson who grabs it at the two. He's got great speed. And he's going to get to the outside almost.
What a play by Ronnie Prue.
Yes, it was.
Manson showed a little strength to break the first two tackles, and it looked like he was going to break contain. But Ronnie Prude, who that's his responsibility, he's playing a little bit of a safety on that, and made the sure tackle in the open field. And again, the pressure now falls again on Chris Lee, and the necessity for him to hit some pass plays. They've got to have a little balance, and it's not their running game that needs to be picked up.
LSU brings four defensively. They toss it to the left side, and Keyston Moore is hauled out of bounds by Allie Highsmith. We go back once again to Tim Brando in New York.
You might want to learn the chorus of the fight song in Michigan if you're Todd Blacklett. Here's Chad Henne, 33 yards, true freshman Mario Manningham. Then Mike Hart runs it in for the two-point conversion. Six and change, and we're tied at 18, Vern.
Well, he's not yet warming up the vocal cords for Hail to the Victors. Not yet.
That Mario Manningham, I coach high school basketball, and he beat us at a last-second shot in high school last year.
Second down and 12. Rolling pocket, right side, Leak delivers it. Oh, broken tackle. Chad Jackson has it, and he is knocked out of bounds. No, he's in, still in bounds at the 25-yard line, a gain of 8. Jackson.
And here is the critical down for Florida now. Third down and 4. They are 1 for 11 on third down conversions today. It's difficult to possess the ball. It's difficult to have any kind of continuity on offense if you don't convert third downs.
And in their last 2 weeks prior to this game, they were only 8 of 29. So they've really been inept at third down conversions the last 3 games. Leak looking left, puts it on, tries to run. Allie Highsmith, fourth down. Kyle Williams.
Well, it's pressure against the empty, and then it's man-to-man coverage. But Chris Leak, nowhere to go with the football. Look at the coverage. Dead, dead, nothing, nothing, nothing. I mean, 5 guys out, nobody open anywhere. And Chris Leak sacked again and brings up fourth down.
Kyle Williams, second sack of the season, the heart and soul of this defense. There's the rugby kick. This one very, very low, but they do get a roll. And it will be down at the 45-yard line. 35-yard punt for a very busy Eric Wilbur. Kyle Williams, one of the seniors on this ball club. He's there to help with the sack.
The Home Depot SEC on CBS is sponsored by the Home Depot, Wrangler, Cadillac, and by State Farm.
Back at Tiger Stadium, you think this game doesn't mean something to these folks? This is John Hevesty, offensive line coach for Florida.
Yeah, he wasn't doing that because he had a bee stuck in his headset. I mean, he heard something about what happened on that last pass play on third down, and he let his offensive line guys know what he heard.
And that was the senior Mike DeGore, who was directly in the line of sight.
1 for 12 on third down today for Florida.
4 for 16 against Alabama, 4 for 13 against Mississippi State. So a trend has been established. Here's the handoff to a dive, breaks, and a flag. This one's going to come back. Well, why the significance of this game? Georgia undefeated. They play at Vandy tonight. Florida gets Georgia in 2 weeks in Jacksonville, but they need to keep pace. And out west, Alabama wins today at Ole Miss 13-10. They go to 4-0 in the conference. LSU trails by a game in the loss column, and they've got Auburn, and then they go to Alabama in the middle of November.
Well, that's why, I mean, you can put this game, obviously, is important, because the loser of this game, their team realistically doesn't have a very good chance at all of getting to Atlanta, and the winner stays on course. But truth be told, even whoever wins this game, their next game, respectively, is even more important because it's within the division. Florida plays Georgia after a week off. LSU at home next week against Auburn.
Ninth penalty against LSU. Here comes the rush from Mincy, and he's got him. Jerome Mincy broke through the block unimpeded.
And how big was the holding penalty a play before? Because they looked like they had a good run. Mincy, again, just continues to have an outstanding season. They're moving the pocket to get Russell outside. Reggie Nelson coming on the blitz, and Jeremy Mincy, the sack leader on this team, now with four sacks on the year.
And a second down and 32. Holding call, sack. 9:45 to go. Blitz coming. Hand off. Adai gets a little bit of it back to the 30-yard line. That's a gain of 7. Jarvis Moss with the tackle, getting more and more playing time defensively for Florida.
If you would have told me any time before this game that Florida would be in this game, down by less than a touchdown, and only have, what, 50 yards of passing offense or something like that, 57 yards, I would have said, you're out of your mind. There's no way they could be in this game if they couldn't throw the football.
Of course, 9 penalties and 5 turnovers have helped.
That helps a lot.
Third and 25. Four-man rush by the Gators. Russell, with a lot of time, finds his tight end. But that only moves the ball out to the 39-yard line. It'll be fourth and a ton.
You give him that throw and just try to make a good tackle and get the ball back.
So on fourth down, Chris Jackson on. And Vernell Brown.
I wouldn't be surprised if Florida tries to go after this kick. I mean, again, their punt return has just been pathetic this year for whatever reason. I don't understand that with all the skill athletes that they have. But I think their best chance is to maybe go after this punt and turn the game that way.
And they do come. Reggie Nelson almost got there. It is a boomer. Oh, brother! Chris Jackson! Yeah. 55 yards.
You know, I'm almost ready to give some athletic props to a kicker. Chris Jackson, also the starting third baseman on LSU's baseball team. He's almost made it in my book. 21-17, Tigers.
Hell's freezing. Step closer indeed, and the big foot of Chris Jackson.
Oh, 55
yard punt.
Outstanding punt.
Fair catch called at the 6.
That was a huge sequence for LSU right now, because Florida has not threatened them with their passing game, and now they've got 94 yards to go.
Leak is 7 of 20 from the end zone. He'll throw on first down, and he'll go way deep for Dallas Baker, and it is almost picked off. A collision of the two defensive backs. Chivas Jackson, number 21.
That's about the third time that Chris has tried to throw to Dallas Baker deep against double coverage. Chivas Jackson is coming from a safety position to help his fellow corner Prude, and the two of them are fighting for the football, but Dallas Baker, no chance to make the catch there.
Leak now 7 of 21. It's second down and 10 for Urban Meyer's team at the 6-yard line.
And where is Chad Jackson and Jamel Cornelius? I mean, they have just been non-factors at all in this game.
Hand off to Sean Wynn. Jammed up. He picks up about 3.5 out near the 10-yard line. Cameron Vaughn. Ryan Willis, number 52. There's Vaughn, the last man up. Cameron Vaughn, who replaces Lionel Turner in the middle this year. They've also E.J. Kowale, who was the starting weak side linebacker, broke an ankle. They expect him back maybe in a week or two. They also lost Ali Broussard, their outstanding running back before the season. And here we are, 3rd and 6, with 7:23 to go. Empty backfield again. LSU will blitz on this empty backfield leak. And it's caught. It's caught by Jamel Cornelius, and they get the first down at the 25.
And how about the courage of Chris Leak to stay in there? He's had a rough night. He has not been able to hit anything. Here's Cornelius, blitz read right over the middle, so it's right in the vision of Chris Leak. He sticks it in there between three defenders, and only their second conversion on third down the entire ballgame.
Cornelius with the catch. It's a first and 10 at the 25. Under seven remaining. This one jammed up. Deshaun Wynn, gang tackle. They'll give him the 21. He lost three.
Yeah. If you want to run against this defense, you've got to block Kyle Williams and Claude Roten. We haven't called Roten's name too many times. They do a little twist in there, a little stunt between the two tackles, and nobody picks up Kyle Williams. And then he picks up Deshaun Wynn.
Kyle Williams, a newlywed on this team. He and his wife, Jill, married last spring. Had the D-line over to the house on Thursday night. She fixed dinner for 20.
Yeah.
Crawfish and sausage fettuccine.
That sounded good. I wish I'd have been there.
Second down and 12. Leak going right. Under pressure, goes deep again, and this one's going to be well beyond the sideline. Another upstate on Penn State. Here's Tim.
All right, Vern, Michigan up three after kicking a field goal, and then Michael Robinson's pass for Penn State will be picked off by Leon Hall. He'd bring it back 33 yards to set up another opportunity for Michigan. They're inside the 12-yard line, and it's been a great year for you, Vern, a great week in the Texas Hall of Fame, and Texas Lutheran does it again, 44-41 over Louisiana College from nearby Pineville, Louisiana. It took them four overtimes to beat Louisiana College last year. 64-62 was the score then.
Thank you, Timmy. There's joy in Seguin, Texas, even though my partner is not going to speak for a little bit. So while he gets his breath back, we'll take timeout. Hail to the victors indeed. Line stat of the game, third down conversions, Florida 2 of 13. Get complete game stats at CBSSportsline.com.
LSU coming in third in the conference on third down defense. They've been outstanding today. None bigger than this one right here. Third and 12 with 6 minutes left in the ballgame.
Five receivers for Chris Leak on third and 12.
They blitz the empty a lot. Here they come again.
And they do. And Leak is hit, rolls right. There's a hold. And Leak is hit by Cameron Vaughn. And let's go with the ball. If this is indeed holding, it will be declined.
And they, on this empty set on third down, they have made Chris Leak so uncomfortable because he's starting to scramble up in the pocket before he even finishes his drop. He's taken the snap, and watch, as soon as he hits his last step, he's already starting up in the pocket, anticipating things to collapse. Free rusher from the outside, he's got to take off. And another stop on third down by this LSU defense. We wondered, would they be as dominant defensively as they have been the last 2 weeks against lesser opponents? Well, on third down, they've been every bit as dominating.
The penalty is holding. It is declined. It will be fourth down. Skylar Green as Eric Wilbur on to punt again. Green back. Wilbur's been very effective today. Speaking of punting, here's the rugby punt. Think of the significance of that Chris Jackson punt on LSU's last possession. And again, Skylar Green unable to get his hands on the ball.
You know, I don't go back to LSU's last offensive drive. It's a lot of little things that make a difference in a football game. LSU had the football, and they ran on first down and had a good run, but there was a penalty. So now they're back 15 yards. They run again. They get a few yards back. On third down, they complete it underneath. They don't pick up the first down, but they move the yardage so the punter, Chris Jackson, has more room to kick. Fair catch is made on the 6-yard line, and when Florida gets the ball, they've got 94 yards to go. They just moved the field position dramatically, even though they didn't convert a first down.
5:45 to go in this one. Both teams have two timeouts remaining. And a flag.
Movement. A lot of penalties. It's sloppy in that sense.
That's 10 against LSU.
Prior to the snap, false start on number 75 on the offense. Penalty is 5 yards. Remains first down.
Brian Johnson. Now Red Lobster presents today's scholar athlete, Rudy Neiswanger. Perfect. 4.0, grad student. He's going to go to med school, three-time academic honor roll All-American, and a semifinalist for the 2005 Draddy Trophy, which will be presented early December at the Waldorf Astoria in New York City.
Both centers in this game are semifinalists for the Draddy Award. Mike DeGoria, Florida, also.
First down and 15. They'll keep it on the ground. A die hit by Marcus Thomas as he gets to the 40-yard line. 5:38 to go. LSU, 10 penalties, 5 turnovers, yet they lead by 4.
And that shows a couple things. I mean, it shows character of their players to fight off that and hang with it and take the lead in the fourth quarter. And it also shows some character on your coaching staff, not to panic and not to lose it when those things go against you. They had control of the game. They lost the lead momentarily, but now they're back in control at this point.
Second down and 12. They toss it to Adai. What a workhorse he's been today.
Well, he is. You know, Justin Vincent, he fumbled, I think, his first carry of the game, and they just have been very reluctant to put him back in the ballgame because you cannot, absolutely cannot afford another turnover at this point in the game.
Adai now 28 carries, Todd, for 142 yards, career highs.
Florida has not shown the capacity or the ability today to drive the football the length of the field. So play conservative here, punt the football again, and make them go the long field. Would not be surprised to see LSU run the football here.
Third and 7. Clock is stopped by the officials. Timeout is called by LSU. That will leave them with one timeout, 4 minutes and 21 seconds to go. Les Miles' team leads by 4. Midway through the fourth quarter, time for our Wrangler 5-star premium denim jeans play of the game. It was 3rd and 9, and LSU had the ball. Here's Jim Hawthorne's call.
Hang on the snap. There it is. He has time to throw. Can't find a receiver now. He throws deep, and there's Bo, and he's caught it at the 12. Down he goes.
31-yard throw to set up an Adai touchdown. And there's Dwayne Bowe. Joseph Adai in the backfield, 3rd down. And they'll go from the spread, 3rd and 7. Jamarcus Russell buys some time, dances right, pulls up, and steps out of bounds.
He was out.
Good thing he did, because Earl Everett had picked it off.
I'll tell you, I think Jimbo Fisher, who's right next to me in the booth, is gonna. Boy, he's gonna lose some hair tonight. These turnovers. Here's Jimbo, the 6th year as the offensive coordinator, and he saw Jamarcus earlier in the game get towards the sideline and throw one back in the field, a play that got picked off. That one would have been as well if he wouldn't have stepped out of bounds.
Chris Jackson had a sensational punt last time LSU had to punt, 55 yards. It's 4th and 11 here.
D. Webb, 2 block kicks on the season, a block punt last week, number 15.
And here's Jackson's punt, high but relatively short. And this one bounces at the 16, taken by Vernell Brown. He's out of bounds at the 16. That's a very effective punt by Chris Jackson. 49 yards this time. I said it was shorter. It was only shorter by 6. Tiger Stadium, record crowd, 21-17. LSU jumped out 14-0 early in this game. Florida fought back, scored 17 unanswered points in the second and third quarters, and then a lengthy drive by LSU gave them a 4-point lead that they enjoy right now. 4:02 to go.
And those seniors on the field right now for LSU's defense, Kyle Williams, Claude Roden, have never beaten Florida here in Baton Rouge. The Gators have won 3 consecutive games here with 3 different coaches. Or 2 different, rather.
There was a fair catch signal given by the receiving team. Therefore, we have delay of game on the receiving team. The penalty is 5 yards from the end of the kick. First down.
I didn't see the fair catch signal from Vernell Brown. But it now they here they are again. Yeah. 5 yard line.
Here they are again. 95 yards away in a passing game that has been virtually non-existent.
Two timeouts left. And they'll go with the empty backfield, which has invited LSU's blitz game previous occasions many, many times.
Yeah, they have. That's been the MO for Bo Pelini today. When they go empty, let's bring in some extra pressure. Now they drop off a defensive lineman, so they're not selling out. They still have a free safety, Deron Landry, but they're bringing pressure against the empty.
This time only four come. Leak. And there's contact. The catch is made. Ronnie Prude is going to be flagged. Now they're two flags down. Dallas Baker does make the catch, and it will be a first down if the play stands.
And so what happened on that play, Florida brings Deshaun Wynn back into the backfield to have an extra blocker. As soon as that happens, if there was a blitz called by LSU, they take it off and only rush four. They've only blitzed when there's been no back in the backfield.
Pass interference on the defense, number 8. We have a catch on the play. It is also a spot foul. Automatic first down.
That is the third penalty called on Ronnie Prude this afternoon. And Leak for the day is 8 of 24. Wynn in the backfield alongside Chris Leak. Pumps once. Goes right. Chased by Roten.
This play was messed up. This was supposed to be a wide receiver screen to Chad Jackson.
Flag at the 25-yard line, Todd. On the near side.
Well, it looks like they might call ineligible men downfield, which if they'd have thrown the ball as a screen behind the line of scrimmage, that's okay. But when they threw it past the line of scrimmage and men downfield, they might call ineligible downfield. In college football, if you run a screen and throw it behind the line of scrimmage, you can release your lineman downfield to block. You can't do that in pro football. Chris Leak, for whatever reason, didn't see the screen setting up and went to the other side and threw it away from the screen.
Ineligible receiver downfield on the offense, number 74. Penalty is 5 yards. Replay first down.
So you can't blame Randy Hand, the left tackle, for this penalty. It's supposed to be a wide receiver screen to Chad Jackson. All right, now nobody comes out for the screen. Here's the lineman, but there's no receiver for the screen over here. So Chad Jackson or some receiver made a mistake on that side. Chris Leak tried to save the play by throwing it away. Instead, they get a penalty.
First and 15, back at the 11. Wynn sets up alongside Chris Leak. Leak, again, good downfield coverage. There's a flag. This one will come back. It'll be holding on Florida as Leak is down by Chivas Jackson, number 21. Now, we talked a lot about the 10 penalties against LSU in this game. Florida has had a few themselves. That's the 8th on the Gators.
And Chris Leak has just looked, you know, I've seen him when he's looked good and looked comfortable.
Right.
He didn't look comfortable in Tuscaloosa a few weeks ago, and he's looked even more uncomfortable today against LSU. They just have gotten pressure on him, and even when they haven't gotten pressure on him, his receivers have not been able to get open.
71 yards today, the career low. Tennessee, his most significant start his freshman season was here.
Yeah, that's right.
A 19-7 victory by Florida, the only loss in LSU's national championship season. First down and 20. Leak deep down the middle for Cornelius, makes the grab and then fumbles the ball. Do they give it to him?
No, I don't think
incomplete.
He held on to it.
Okay.
That was a beautiful throw by Chris Leak. I mean, he's had a rough day. He has not looked sharp throwing the football, but this ball was thrown beautifully down the middle out of his own end zone. Threw it right past the ear of Cameron Vaughn, the linebacker in coverage. And Cornelius, who is not 100%, and it's obvious he is not feeling 100%,
Are we sure that wasn't a catch?
I don't know. From that angle, it looked like he maybe did have it, and when he hit the ground, it popped out.
Are we sure that was not a catch?
They're not sure upstairs. They're going to look at it.
Rogers Redding is the replay official.
If he had it and the ground caused the ball to come out, it's a completion. The question will be, did he have control when he hit the ground?
Regular speed.
Hard to tell with his back there.
And again, of course, the call was incomplete.
That's right. It's called incomplete on the field. It has to be indisputable evidence to wave that off.
I saw one knee down. I'm thinking of John Madden's insistence that one knee equals 2 feet.
I don't know. The more I see that, the more it looks like he might have caught the football. Because the ball wasn't bobbling around. That was the thing. It came out quickly when he hit the ground, but it didn't look like he was bobbling it as he was going down.
Regular speed, and the call was an incomplete pass. Three officials concurred.
Boy, is this a tough call.
Wow. There must be the indisputable visual evidence to overturn the call that was made on the field. Rogers Redding, the replay official.
But how about the throw by Chris Lee? Mm-hmm. Just when it looked like he hasn't been able to connect on any big-time throw, he sticks one in there beautifully. 8 of 25 for 71 yards, pending the outcome of this play. But boy, oh boy.
Well, Chris Leak is taking the opportunity to chat with the offensive coordinator, Dan Mullen, and this is taking quite some time. It's supposed to be accomplished inside of 2 minutes.
And we have a couple of the LSU coaches looking over the partition here at our replays. You know, the press box area up here is still under construction. They don't have TVs in the boxes, and it's all on our replay.
That is regular speed. And LaRon Landry went over to scoop up the ball. Here comes Terry Brown.
The ruling on the field was an incomplete pass. We have conclusive video evidence that the pass was incomplete. The receiver lost possession of the ball. Therefore, we have an incomplete pass. The ruling on the field stands as called. Second down.
Well, I don't want to get into an argument with either Rogers Redding or Terry Brown. He said there was indisputable evidence that the catch was not made. I'd say there wasn't enough evidence to overrule the call.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, it has to be indisputable that he had it.
I know we're picking hairs here, but it's now second down and 20. It's at the six. Win wide, way wide left. Leak steps up. He'll run, but not very far. Up to the 11.
You know, they just have not done a good job of blocking the outside rushers today either, because Chris Lee very seldom has been able to just set up in the pocket, take a little step up, and still keep his vision downfield to throw. I mean, he has had to run up the field. Chase Pittman got a good outside rush that time and forced him to leave the pocket again. Very few times today have we seen Chris able to stand in the pocket and throw the football.
Third and 13.
I wouldn't anticipate blitz here.
Florida's 2 of 14 on third down conversions. There is a blitz. Leak got a man wide open. Dallas Baker. And a flag is thrown. Baker all by himself up near the 35-yard line.
That was the one reason I didn't anticipate to see blitz there. Third down and 13. Make Chris Leak execute it. Let him throw it underneath. But don't give up a big play with man-to-man. Now, is this going against Florida or against LSU?
Might be ruled a push by Dallas Baker. Here's Terry Brown. Oh, you will hear a roar if that's the rule.
Well, everybody's walking that way. So I think it is.
Well, listen to this reaction.
Pass interference against the offense, number 81. The penalty half the distance to the goal. Remains third down.
Third down and 13. These two guys have been battling all night. Ronnie Prude and Dallas Baker. Oh, that's a bad call. I mean, he's just getting off press coverage. How is that pass interference? Oh, my gosh. I don't agree with that at all.
Nor I.
I mean, these two guys have been banging the whole game. And you teach a receiver to be physical against press coverage and get off the coverage. That's a bad call.
Cold case, CSI Miami in 48 hours. The lineup tonight, third and 20. Really was a terrible call. Third down. Out of the gun. Blitz again. Leak goes right side again. Prude and Baker again. It's incomplete. It'll be fourth down again. With 2:12 to go. Florida, two timeouts left.
Six.
And it appears that, they're going to send Eric Wilbur on. I thought for a moment they might just say, what the heck? Well, they've got two timeouts left.
Yeah, they can't do that. Nope. They've got their defense has played too well, not just today, but all season. Don't put him in a no-win situation.
Urban Meyer doing a little coaching. Eric Wilbur is on to punt yet again. That's his 10th of the ball game.
He has been right on the money on the directional punting. I'll tell you, that's not an easy thing to do, and he's kicked it a couple different ways.
50 yards that time. Time for another Penn State update. Here's Timmy Brando.
All right, Vern, this is unreal. Michael Robinson will take it in from 3 yards out. They converted on this drive, a 4th and 7, were aided by a pass interference penalty. After that run back of an interception of Robinson, they wound up getting a pooch punt out of that. And USC does now have a 3-point lead on Notre Dame, 27-24, with 5 and change remaining. Vern?
Thank you, Tim.
How much time was left in that game?
18 seconds. We got him smiling again, Tim. Got him smiling. And Tracy's not too happy.
Oh, Michael Robinson, I love you.
Oh, goodness. First down and 10. Here's the handoff to Adai. What a busy afternoon he's had. Look at him break the tackle.
Look at him protect that football the whole way.
What a run, Joseph Adai.
Florida trying to rip the football out, knowing that the only chance they have right now is to get that ball back quickly. Joseph Adai anticipating that. Covers up the ball with both arms and just keeps his legs churning. Never slows down. They're ripping for the football, and he keeps ripping forward. Oh, my gosh. Another penalty on LSU.
Hey, it looks that way.
Holding on the offense, number 64. Field is 10 yards from the spot of the foul. Replay first down.
Wow. Rudy Neiswanger, the center.
Unbelievable.
Yet another penalty. That's 12.
This is an outside toss play, and the center gets called for. Well, he did. He tackled the middle linebacker, Earl Everett. Watch Earl Everett get tackled right here by the center. And, you know, referee's right there looking at it.
And that negates a 34-yard gain. It's first and 14. 12 penalties.
Not a very smart decision by the smartest guy on the field.
4.0 pre-med. Flunk that one. Here's a handoff. A die. And the clock will continue to unravel with 1:26 to go, and it's stopped now. Let's see if this is Florida calling their last timeout. No. LSU.
No, they.
That's. No, it couldn't be. I couldn't imagine that. So Florida now reduced to one timeout. 1 minute, 23 seconds to go. 21-17, Tigers.
Tim Brando in New York, an incredible comeback in Morgantown. West Virginia's Steve Slayton is going to take it in from a yard out, his third touchdown of the day. They've come from behind to tie the game. They're going to go into overtime, and Michigan has just beaten Penn State on the last play. We'll get back to you with that update in just a moment. Back to you, Vern.
Thank you, Tim. What an afternoon in college football,
yes,
huh? What an afternoon. Fun to be a part of it. And back at Tiger Stadium, sad faces, some forlorn looks. Chris Leak on the far side, 21-17 with 1:26 to go. Joseph Addai out to the 45-yard line. That'll set up a third down. And let's go back and take a look at the pass interference call on Dallas Baker.
Yeah, well, I was pretty vocal about it being a bad call, but here's what probably was seen. Right there, Dallas Baker has a hold of Ronnie Pruitt's jersey, and he pulls forward and gains the advantage. He clearly grabbed the jersey and pulled. It was third down and 13, negated for the penalty. Maybe not such a bad call. I'm sorry.
Tim Brando in New York. Again, that incredible fourth and four play that won it for Michigan on the game's final play. Mario Manningham, that basketball player that did in Todd Blackledge, does it again. Penn State's six-game win streak is over, 27-25. The final, Michigan's beaten the Nittany Lions seven times in a row. Back to you, Vern.
Oh, my gosh. Oh, my gosh. You probably won't hear from Todd for the rest of the game. 1:21 to go in this one, third and 10. And here's Addai with his 32nd carry of the day.
And he stays in bounds.
Yes, he does.
Did they? Oh, they're stopping the clock. I thought he did a great job of sliding to stay in bounds, knowing that he didn't want the clock to stop.
Take a look at the end of it.
And Joseph Addai knows, don't stop the clock. Get what you can and then get down. Try to get down in bounds. Dangerously close to the sideline, but he made a great effort to try to keep that clock moving.
Unable to do so, so it brings up fourth down. And Chris Jackson is on fourth and five. Vernell Brown is the deep man.
That was huge. I mean, that's a matter of about 40 seconds because Florida had no more timeouts. They could have let it go all the way down here before they punted the football.
Well, you and I could hear the coaching staff from LSU to our right banging against the wall. Here's the kick by Jackson. He and Eric Wilbur have been superb today.
Yes.
That one goes into the end zone. It'll be a touchback, a 51-yard punt. So with 65 seconds to go, out of timeouts, Florida gets the ball 80 yards away. Chris Leak talking with Dan Mullen upstairs, a 33-year-old offensive coordinator at the University of Florida.
Well, you've got to work fast because you have no timeouts. And if I'm Urban Meyer and Dan Mullen, I don't think I go with empty backfield. I would keep a guy in there so Chris Leak can at least set his feet and try to throw the ball down the field.
And that man is Deshaun Wynn. Four wideouts. Low snap. Leak has it. Steps up. Goes down. Kyle Williams.
The defensive line of LSU.
Melvin Oliver.
The strength of their team, Melvin Oliver, the senior, Claude Roten, Kyle Williams, just collapsing the Florida pass protection. Chase Pittman, here they come again.
Six sacks today. Leak rolls right, Chase Pittman, the pass.
Great throw.
Caught.
Great throw.
First down at the 31-yard line, 20-yard gain. The catch made by Chad Jackson.
Six sacks today, six sacks last week against Jay Cutler, seven sacks the week before against Mississippi State. And now for LSU, 42 games in a row with at least one sack. Pressure defense has kind of been the trademark here, whether it's Nick Saban or now Bo Pelini, the new defensive coordinator.
First down and 10 at the 31. Leak the time, right side. Miscommunication with Dallas Baker. It'll be second and 10. Urban Meyer and Florida. Louisiana State University. This the first of a four-game homestand. and the first 2 weeks of normalcy for this Louisiana State football team. 32 players from New Orleans, many lost their homes and a lot more. Second down and 10. Here's Chris Leak stepping up, pumps. He's across the line of scrimmage, and he finally dumps it off. He was dangerously close to the line. There is no, yes, there is a flag. I think he crossed the line. If so, it'll go against Florida. There's one young man in the multitude down on the LSU sidelines. His name is Donald Haynes. He's a walk-on defensive lineman from Diamondsburg, Mississippi. It was 10 days after Katrina hit until he was notified that his mom and dad were alive. 10 days. He was on the practice field when Jack Marucci, the trainer, got a phone call from his dad. Walked out and said, "We're doing fine." It's hard to explain,
yes,
what these kids in this state and the people, all of them, have been through, and why this means so much.
And a little different fourth quarter performance, atmosphere, response than the last time they were in Tiger Stadium against Tennessee.
Leak on third down. Lateral, hook and lateral, Gavin Dickey.
He was down, I think.
It's picked up by Cameron Vaughn, and the ball is ruled down by one official. The other says okay, but the umpire says ball down at the 29.
And this will probably give Florida, well, no, they won't get another play because they can't stop the clock. Game over.
The game is over. LSU has won. There is no touchdown. Urban Meyer and Les Miles. Chase Pittman, congratulated by the Florida head coach.
These are two very, very good defensive football teams. Offensively, both of them have some issues. Two good defenses.
Let's go down to Tracy.
Coach, after all this team has been through, how big of a win is this, especially in front of your home crowd?
Well, we needed to get it started here in our home properly. We needed to win this game, simply put. It was as ugly a victory as there is. I'll take it every time, but we got a work to do. We got to correct a lot of things. This will not go away fast. It's going to take the guys inside those LSU helmets to look at themselves and change things.
Coach, thank you so much. Congratulations.
Yeah, a good victory anyway.
You did something Nick Saban never did. You beat Florida here at home.
Thank you.
Joseph Addai, big man on campus. Tonight, cold case, CSI Miami. And 48 hours mystery. Despite 5 turnovers and 12 penalties, LSU wins it 21-17. The seniors beat Florida at home for the first time. For Tracy Wolfson and Todd Blackledge, I'm Vern Lundquist. Goodbye from Baton Rouge.